And so my sister was working at this hotel, and when I got this new pet dog, but it was a really weird dog, it was like a blue dog, the dog just kept harassing the place and it was tearing things up. And then a few days later, we went around the island because we were living in Hawaii at this point, and the dog was just like playing the guitar, pretending to be Elvis. It was a real fun time. And then all of a sudden, these two aliens started really shooting at us and trying to capture us and put us in this little capsule. Apparently, it turns out my dog wasn't a dog, and it was actually an alien called Project 626. Anyway, it was a whole thing. I nearly got taken away from my sister at the time, and there was like a guy there who was like looking after kids, you know, puts kids in the right homes and fosters them and stuff like that. He was called Mr. Bubbles, but he was huge, and yeah, it was really weird. He sounded like Ving Rhames, actually. Really weird. But
I don't even know what this reference is from. what is this supposed to be?
It's Lilo and Stitch.
Oh, I've never actually seen that movie.
All right, okay. Somehow. Fair enough.
Which I know I'm probably going to get a lot of flack for. Shout out to all of you beautiful people that are here for the pre-show. Of course, as usual, pre-show, just to make sure everything's working all right and to make sure people get a chance to come in before we officially start. So thanks to all of you for showing up, and as well all the people that subbed so far. Undercover Brother, thank you so much, man, as well as GH Beats and Rabbit Sensei says ooh-woo nice. And hey-hey, respectively.
Yeah, and Rabbit, if it's the same Rabbit, he's kind enough to send me some codes for our build stream giveaways and stuff like that. So I have a ton more codes to add onto the list.
Ooh, nice. Yeah, I'll be putting some of those codes to use tomorrow, probably, for a little bit of a giveaway. But I'll announce that a little bit later during the announcements.
Nice. Yep, I'll be putting some to use on Sunday on my usual build stream.
Heck yes. Gio says he's more disappointed in me. I've just never seen the movie. I don't know. I don't watch a ton of movies. I really don't.
You should watch. There's some good references in it.
I don't doubt it. I'm sure it's fantastic, and it's incredibly popular, if nothing else.
Well, we got Disney Plus, so my wife has been watching Disney movies left, right, and center. So, because it only launched in the UK about 2 weeks ago, so we've been using that. Undercover Brother says my beard is coming nice and full. It is. Like I usually get my beard cut when I go to, or like trimmed and shaped and everything, when I go to the barbers, and because I can't go to the barbers, it's growing in thick and fast. It's not slowing. It's getting there.
I didn't actually realize, but yeah, you're starting to grow it out.
Yeah. I don't really have much choice at the minute.
Yeah, I've seen some of my friends have just been like posting on Facebook and stuff. They're looking for like mobile barbers to like come to their house and like cut their hair and trim their beards and stuff.
Man, yeah,
crazy, man.
It is. Jay Shop with the 500 barber free bits. Thank you very much, man. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jay Shop.
His bit donations are always really, really kind of themed around what we're talking about at that particular moment in time. I've noticed that. Yeah, it's fun. I like it. Always really on topic and on point.
He's probably one of the few people that actually watches this show and pays attention. Bearded well, I for the Twitch Prime sub. Thanks, man.
Yeah, thank you, Billy. So I prototypes, I do like a weekly thing where I put like an update out every Thursday stroke Friday. There's always a weekly update that goes out to let people know what's happening and stuff. But I don't do my email blast. I just put an announcement in the prototypes Discord server. And I assume that no one ever reads it unless they're looking for an update. So I assume that no one ever reads it. So I posted it and posted it as I always do. And within 5 minutes, about 11 people asked me about something that was in there. And it was like, okay, so you do read it. Okay, nice. It was... one of those people are paying attention. It's nice feeling.
Absolutely. Visionaire says it's time for Tiger King. Ugh, I don't know about that.
I haven't watched it either.
I know it's like the world's most popular show at the moment, but I've yet to see it.
Yeah, not for me.
I don't know. I've seen like part of the trailer, and it didn't really seem like it was for me either. But everyone seems to be really enjoying it. So, who am I to judge?
I don't know. Pokemon Kids here as well, repping the British crowd.
Heck yeah. Oh, should we do a quick mail call as well?
Oh, yeah. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, so mine's pretty easy. I just got one thing in. I got the board I'm using right now, a Baka 60. So
maybe
you're unfamiliar with this board. It was a private group by board, sort of, I guess, by Chewy over at Mechs on Deck. Pretty nice, 60%. Mm. Just nothing terribly fancy. Brass plate, brass weight, top mount, if I'm not mistaken. Just came in.
Nice.
It's this one's actually I got it for a ridiculously low price. I pretty much could not say no. That's how low the price was. And it's unfinished, so
oh nice
on camera. But yeah, I need to figure out what color I want to get this Cerakoted, because I do have a Cerakote shop about 10 or 15 minutes away from me.
What you should do is you should actually polish it, polished aluminium. Yeah,
you think so?
That would be good. Yeah. Just get some like Brasso and just hand polish it. You can have some like, real different tones across the board. It'll look great. Great.
Perhaps. I don't know if I'm that fancy. I don't know if I can do that. That's more of a you thing. I'm not cool enough to pull off stuff like that.
I just like to do things, get in the shop and do stuff. Yeah, that's me. For my mail call, I got a few things. I got another set of Triumph Adler. You might remember that I had the drop set of Triumph Adler a couple of days ago. This is again the 2015 set, but this came as part of a bundle off of a purchase with some original Triumph Adler typewriter caps. So I now have two sets of these, which means I can have some. So I've got this set, and then there's another set in a tub to the side. But these, the original PBT, the really thick die-subbed cherry keycaps that were on the old Triumph Adler machines. So they're really cool. So I'm going to mix the alphas from the typewriter with the mods from the GMK set. And I'm going to have that on a couple of different boards. I also got in 8008, or Boob, or 8008, or whatever you want to call it, the Dixie Mech thing with the new thing, new boxes. I haven't opened this as yet. It's still sealed. I'll open it whenever it's going to go on the board. I also got GMK Merlin in. So
I wish you would open that.
I have opened this.
Oh, have you?
So okay. I have opened this. Yeah, like I hadn't seen anyone else post any pictures of this. So
that's why I want
like,
to 8008, see
8008. I've seen a load of people post pictures. So this is the set. It's not going to be particularly representative in this particular angle, but there you go. You can kind of see what it looks like. But it's really nice. The yellow works really well in it.
Yeah, looks pretty good. You'll have to take some nice pictures after you put it on a board as well.
Yeah, I will do. I think that might go on the build stream on Sunday, actually, when we get around to doing that as well. So someone mentioned that don't shake that box for 8008. I don't know if you guys will hear this, but if I tip the box, they're all loose already. I can hear them and feel them. The box bulges at one side. So, yeah. And then the final thing I got was I actually got two Kipuras in today. One was a collaboration between myself and Johansky, who runs Alpha Keycaps, which was the JO2 Kipura, which is like a white and copper themed Kipura, which is really, really nice. And I also got in a win from the last round that he did, which was the Celestial Kipura, which matches GMK Noel. So. There we go. So now I have to buy that set, even if I wasn't considering it before, which I was, but now I have to buy it.
Yeah. I think I bought it the day it went live.
I didn't, but I have since bought it, so there we go.
Yeah. It's gonna be
Thank you very much to Luna Summer, subscribed for 24 months, a 2-year streak, a 2-year birthday. Thank you very much for that. Teal Technic with 100 bits. And Jack Static as well, with a 12 months of subs, but a 3-month streak, saying much love, guys. So thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. You guys are the best. You know that? Every single one of you. Fantastic. Absolutely. All right. With that said, we're going to roll an intro, and we're going to get right into the keyboard stuff. That song was terrible. You don't remember that song?
I do. I wouldn't have sung it if I didn't remember it. I don't know what it is.
I think it's from Limp Bizkit. Rolling. I don't know. Yes. Anyways, terrible musicians aside, let's get back to the show here. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's episode of Talk Black. I am your host, Quakums, joined, as usual, by my lovely co-host, Jay. And we're going to talk about some fantastic keyboard items that are on our news doc today. It is a relatively lengthy news doc today. We're going to try to get through it with a pretty good time frame. But, you know, if it runs a little long, please bear with us. There was a lot of things that happened over the last week. A lot of people just cranking out projects while isolated. So, I don't see that really changing too soon. But anyways, we'll get to that momentarily. How are you doing today, Jay?
I am pretty good. Yeah, I'm tired. I'm having a coffee, but I'm pretty, pretty good. Looking forward to a fun-packed Easter weekend. The wife has got me doing a little bit of DIY, and I've got a new video game coming, which I'm really excited for. And, of course, I'll be doing keyboard content. So it sounds like a good weekend all round.
Very efficient weekend. productive.
Yeah, it's going to be a no sleep but very productive weekend, I think. That's going to have to be the rule. I will have to sacrifice sleep to play video games, which I'm sure none of you responsible people have ever done in your lives. But I think that might have to
be. I have never in my life done that in the last week.
Harry Potter says, which game? The Final Fantasy VII Remake. So it should be delivered to me tomorrow. I won't get a chance to play it tomorrow, but I'll install it. I've got the PS4 version, so I'll install that. And then I'll be sat here, but facing that way on the TV, playing it all day Sunday until stream time, and all day Monday as well. Saturday is DIY day, sadly, and packaging day. So here we go.
Nice. I'm jealous. I don't even own a PS4. And I was hoping it would launch on the PC simultaneously, but sadly, no. Sony wants that exclusivity.
Yeah, I'm just a console scrub, man. So.
I wish I was a console scrub. I wish I had a PS4 right now, then I'd get it too. But sadly, can't always get what we want. Anyways, we have a couple quick announcements to go over just before we roll into the news doc. Of course, just like always, if you have questions, please save those for later. We will end with a Q&A like we always do every single episode. So just keep that in mind, guys. So a couple of quick announcements. We have been doing a lot of streams lately, build streams, as well as some other streams. We did a COVID-19 stream, a little discussion roundtable a while back, and Jay's been doing some Lego streams, some non-keyboard stuff as well. Throughout a lot of this, we're going to be trying to give away, as you've probably noticed, a lot of game codes that have been very generously donated by a lot of you wonderful viewers out there. And we've been trying to just kind of effectively re-gift them to a lot of the people in need, maybe a lot of the people that don't have very much money right now. Maybe they got furloughed, they lost their job because of this, and they're broke and in isolation. So, we're trying to give away a lot of game codes and stuff for that. So keep an eye on that. If you're maybe broke and you want to win some game codes, then make sure you're tuning into a lot of the streams that both Jay and myself are doing. I will be doing one tomorrow, most likely, tomorrow night. I'm planning kind of a late night build stream. After we're going to be on Man of Interest's live stream. So that's our other announcement for today. We mentioned this last week as well, but tomorrow, Friday, April 10th, we're going to be participating in Keyboard Jeopardy. I believe it's actually called the Key Quiz, but it's effectively Jeopardy, but with keyboard questions. And that's going to be over on Man of Interest's Twitch channel, so twitch.tv/Man of Interests. And we are going to be competing head-to-head against the keyboard content studio Mechs on Deck. So, obviously, we're really good friends with Chewie and Osiris over there. They're fantastic people. But we have no choice but to beat them down and in the best way possible. And we are going to absolutely do that during that episode.
Yeah,
so make sure you tune in tomorrow, guys, for that.
It's going to be fun because I don't really understand how the game works particularly. We don't have Jeopardy here in the UK as a game show. So, I'm trying to watch as much as I can to try and learn how to play it. And I'm just going to have to rely on my knowledge and Huey's lack of sticking to the rules to try and get me through. So, yeah, we'll be fine.
Yeah. Jay, I know you're a really smart guy, but it pains me to know that you haven't figured out Jeopardy after 5 minutes of watching it.
I've got it. It's just really difficult for me to get into the mindset of answering with the question, not the answer.
At the end of the day, it's still just a question and answer. That's all it is. And penalize you for not saying what is. So you can
myself for not doing it. That's the thing. I'll feel bad if I do it wrong. And I feel like people will judge me if I don't answer the question and the thing correctly.
You're so silly.
Just why is. It could be other things, or it could be different words there. It could be not why is. It could be who is or what is. Or, you know, there's all sorts of different pronouns we could put.
It's going to be a casual stream. It's not a world renowned game show, right? It's a keyboard Jeopardy quiz on a Man of Interest channel. I think it's going to be a little casual. I think we'll be all right. regardless, yes. Make sure everyone you tune in tomorrow, 6 p.m. Pacific time tomorrow, Friday, April 10th, over on Man of Interest channel. Not this one, Man of Interest channel. However, we will link it tomorrow before we go live in our announcements channel. So as long as you're in the Discord, you'll get the ping for it as well. So just keep that in mind, guys. And of course, come root us on, or come tell us that we're going to get slammed by Mechs on Deck or something. You know, just to show up, have a good time, as we all will be.
Yeah.
It'll be a good
one. Come and make fun of me when I just keep giving answers randomly. Yeah.
Yep.
Do you know what might make it easier? I might just get drunk beforehand. That might be the plan.
There has been talks on whether all of us would be drinking during all of this. And I am totally up for it either way, because I think it'll be hilarious and fun regardless. But that could be a fun thing, too. We'll have to talk to Huey and see what he wants to do.
Yeah, it could be fun if I've had a few drinks.
It'd be a lot of fun if all of us had a few drinks. Shout out to Talisman Solutions for that tier one sub for 19 months. Thank you so much, man.
And the 1,100 bits. There we go.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you are a legend, sir. Thank you so much. And Yanglad in chat as well. It says, I swear I haven't caught a regular TC stream in 2 years. It's been a while, man, but we're always glad to have you.
Yeah, you need to try harder, man. You need to try harder. Just be here. It's not hard. If I can do it, and I'm in the EU, you can do it.
I think, like, nobody watches us, but now that everyone's, like, quarantined, they're like, I guess I'll watch this week's Top Track. Oh, man. Too good. But with that said, let's rock straight into our news, Doc Jay. What do you say about that? Because we have a pretty lengthy one today.
We can definitely do that. Let's try and keep it short, sweet, and succinct.
Yeah, we're going to try to run some internal timers in our head here and try to get through these in just a few minutes each.
I'm not sure why that's a clock, but that was supposed to be a clock.
I never know what goes on in your head, Jay, and I don't know if I ever
Neither
want
do I,
to.
To be honest. Neither do I.
Thank you to Bearded Nut Inc. for the 100 bits, man. Appreciate that. Heck yes.
Jang said, you stream at 3 a.m. my time. Yeah, it's 2 a.m. my time, Jang. It's 2 a.m. here, but it's 2:08 now, so.
If Jay could do it, you could do it. Where's Mountain Blocks for the shirt? Come on.
Yeah.
All right, guys. So, let's rock this news doc real quick. Starting us off today in the keyboard section, we have the interest check for the round 3 of the Hyper 7, which is, of course, the 173% keyboard, which is a hilarious percentage. And Jay knows a little bit about it. I don't know if you can see it behind him. I don't think it's actually angled properly to see
it. It's actually up on the wall here. Yeah, you can't quite see it. Yeah,
but this is kind of the resurrection of the Hyper 7. And if you're not familiar what that is, well, then take a look at this layout. And know that this is not a key set. This is the entire board. So this is the layout of the board. And it requires, 32 U-stabs?
So, yes, it does, but...
Well, it doesn't require them, but you could. You could do up to 30 stabs, right?
Yeah, right. So for those that you don't know, I ran the round 1 and round 2 of the Hyper 7 group buy, and then I gave all of the rights over to Mech Boards for it about 18 months ago and said, you guys can go run round 3. Those are my pictures of the original prototype board. It has slightly changed since then that Brian's showing right now, but I gave it over to Mech Boards. They're going to run round 3. It's all in their space now. Now, originally, the set was designed to use 7 bits from Authority, his Hyper 7 keycap set, which had point of sale caps for the 2U caps. That means that they had 2 switches underneath each cap, and it didn't use a stabilizer. It only had 2 stems on the underside of the cap, and each one used 2 switches. That's not possible with a lot of modern key sets, but Cat Small Cadet, or Cat Space Cadet as it's now called, decided that they wanted to do a Hyper 7 kit as well. So the guys reached out to both me and Mech Boards and said, we want to do a Hyper 7 kit. And Mech Boards went, great, we want to do a Hyper 7 kit again. And that's why the two projects are running in parallel. Now, to make it work with the Space Cadet, Cat Space Cadet set, what they've had to do is have to change it slightly. Instead of having it as 2 switches per 2U key, it has now changed, as Brian was saying, and you can use a stabilizer for those keycaps. So each of those 2U keys that runs across the top, which is the size of a standard backspace key, you can now use with a single switch and a single stabilizer as well. That does mean that if you were to use that rather than the original point of sale keycaps from SP, from Signature Plastics, you will need 30, that is correct, 30 stabilizers on the board.
How many people do you think are going to get this and use 30 stabilizers? Because I want to see at least one person do it, and it's not going to be me. I guarantee you that.
Well, there has already been a handful of the Hyper 7 Space Cadet kits sold for Cat Space Cadet. So that means that some people are intending to do this because they can't use those 2U keys any other way. The Space Cadet uses, so on the layer that you're showing, it actually uses those 2U caps that are across the top that would replace the 2 1U caps that are on the actual layout piece. So if people have bought that, they must be intending to buy this to use it, because the original PCB in place that I ran, they wouldn't support that set. It's only the new version that supports it.
Okay, there's a few people in chat already saying that they're going to use all 30 stabilizers in this. That's pretty intense.
Right?
I can't wait. I want to see a build log of this and or a
build
stream.
I'm doing it. Know I'm going to be streaming one because I've got the case and everything else I made. I'm going to buy the Space Cadet kit from Cat, the Cat Space Cadet kit. I'm going to get one of these as well. Mech Boards have already promised me one. So, there will be a build stream, and there's quite a few people that are saying that they're going to get it. So
that's impressive.
People
that's
just impressive. Want some crazy things. For those asking, it is QMK compatible, so it's all QMK compatible. There is talk of putting it into a VIA or VIA as well. I don't know how far that's come along. Yankar has done the PCB. There's been some slight tweaks to it to accept the stabilizers or the two switches. The rest of the layout remains the same. You cannot have an alternative bottom row. You cannot have ANSI. You cannot have ISO. You get the Hyper 7 layout. That's what it is. The only thing that's changed is you can either have two switches or one switch and a stabilizer for each of those two slots at the top. So there we go.
Yeah, so it looks like we don't have a ton of info yet, but what we do have is we do know it's going to be running on MechBoards UK. We know that, at least by what it sounds like, you can opt for just the PCB or you can opt for a bent plate case as well. Material still unknown, but they're looking into carbon fiber, aluminum, and stainless steel. So all pretty pretty typical materials that you'd see for the plate. But so I know someone mentioned this in chat, but what about like a premium metal case option? Are we ever going to see a case for this?
So the really interesting thing about this is when I ran round two, I spoke to Zondat, who does Nox Redesign. So you've seen his boards before. We talked about them on the show. He actually started to do a case for this and started to do a design. And when we priced it up, it was not particularly cheap, to say the least.
Really?
I won't share pricing, but it was not cheap. It was significantly more expensive than you might think as well. But that was kind of an involved design as well. So since then, a couple of people have reached out and said they want to do cases for it. So we've looked at stacked acrylic things. MechBoards are looking at doing stacked acrylic cases. They're looking at doing bent steel cases. They're looking at doing bent carbon fiber plates. They've asked me to try and price those up because I do carbon fiber group buys as well. They're also tempted to look at doing a really simple aluminium case as well. I know Fropsy said he's going to have a go at trying to design a case, but the big challenge you've got either way is it's going to be really expensive if you do a full metal case. But they are hoping to do some of the kind of the cases that are a little bit cheap in price, like the stacked acrylic and stuff like that, which would really support something like this. It makes it really easy to build as well, and makes it really easy for everyone to get a case. And shout out to Ms. Evil Genius, who did create a solid brass case and brought it to a UK meetup a couple of years ago. So big shout out to them.
That is nuts. That's all I have to say on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so keep your eyes out, guys, because this is coming soon. There's an interest check form in there as well for you to fill out if you're interested.
Enemy's friend does say what MCU does it use. I think it uses at 90 USB, I think. I think, but I'm not 100% certain. So I'm not sure if that does, if that is compatible with VIA or not, or if you have to use the 32U. But yeah.
All right, let's move on to our next topic here. This is the group buy for the Space 65 Cyber Voyager. So as you can see, this actually did open numerous days ago over on April 3rd, I believe. And this is, like we talked about recently, this is the follow-up to the Space 65, the first version. It did have a few minor issues, particularly involving the LEDs on the PCB as well as some of the finishing. However, they've been trying to right their wrongs and they're trying to put out a much better product this time around, which is really cool because I feel like even with the issues, a lot of people still really enjoyed the Space 65. Sold quite a few units, a lot of people buying them and building them and getting a lot of enjoyment out of them. So personally, I think this this new run is even more interesting. And some of you might have been around for, was it Alex Odos did a stream? This is actually his picture, the one he built on stream. It's a prototype. He had a lot of viewers during this stream. It was a really good watch. But it's looking pretty good. I'm not going to go over too many of the specs since we did just cover this very, very recently. But just for a couple quick references, it is going to be top mount, but they are going to be adding noise reduction pads on this one, which leads me to believe it'll probably be a similar solution to like some kind of foam under the the PCB, as well as potentially foam between the PCB and the plate. So we've been seeing a lot more of that lately. It is going to be using a new PCB, so we do have an updated one, thankfully, from Demo Studio. It's going to support USB-C. QMK is going to have ESD protection as well as a reset button. And then the plates are going to be offered in carbon fiber or aluminum, which I believe is a step up from previously where it was just carbon fiber.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. A couple of interesting things I note about this. I think personally, I'm a fan of the older design rather than the new design, the more I look at this, but I do think there is some good improvements here. First and foremost, I think that the way that the case all holds together is going to be vastly improved. The magnetic bar across the back didn't always seem to hold in some, it was very hit and miss in terms of particular boards as to whether it worked or not. I had two on my Space 65, the aluminium one didn't really stick in there with the magnets, it didn't really hold on the back, whereas the brass one that I had was absolutely jam-packed tight, so I don't know if it had different manufacturers for magnets or whatever, or if it just tolerances that were off, but looking at the way this one's built, the fact that that back piece now screws in, that's a much better design choice in my opinion. I think it'd be interesting to see how it sounds. One of the big things is a lot of people loved how the original Space 65 sounded with the carbon fiber plate and the space in the plate and under the PCB as well, so adding foams into there is kind of interesting. I don't know how that's going to change the sound of it, but I'll be interested to see how that affects the build.
Yeah, certainly. So a couple of the other more notable changes, obviously, is this little badge up here in the top left, as well as the LED inserts on the right and left. And this, I don't even know what this thing in the bottom right is called, but it's kind of like a textured accent, I guess.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that as well. I think it kind of adds to the, I don't know. I don't know if I want to call it like a cyberpunk aesthetic, but kind of like that neo-dystopian world kind of feeling. Which is kind of shown in the Cyber Voyager artwork as the first picture. So I don't know. I've been kind of a fan of this theme, this atmosphere, and I think this is a pretty nice one, especially taking into account the price. So $299 is the starting price for a base kit. That's pretty reasonable. It's not quite as good as it was during round one, but the round one design was admittedly simpler. However, that one did start, I think, at $225 for a base kit. So definitely a bit of a price increase here, but obviously they did do a lot more design work here and they put a little bit more effort into it, it seems. So hopefully that'll pay off, but I think either way, the price is pretty good. I think anytime you get a custom keyboard like this for around $300 or less, it's more or less a win in my eyes.
Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't disagree. I think for the price, this is a lot of bang for your buck. And, you know, if people are as happy with these as they were with the round one ones overall, then I think it'll do well.
Yeah,
I think it's already sold pretty well anyway, from what I understand. I know people have been, I've seen quite a few people post what configurations I've gone for in a few Discords and things like that. So be interesting to see how that comes out. But yeah, I'm excited to see these get delivered. I don't think I'll pick one up myself. I've still got my original Space 65, but yeah, I'm excited to see how people's come out.
Yeah, one thing I found that was actually kind of interesting is look at how much stuff they actually include in the base kit, which is quite a bit. But this one stood out to me. It actually comes with tweezers. Just so you can test your PCB before you build. And there's actually a clause in this group buy that they actually say that that's what you should be doing. Always test your PCBs before you build, right down there. So, yeah, that's kind of interesting as well. Layout support is actually pretty dynamic. You can pretty much do anything that you want in this particular layout, including a split spacebar option. So I feel like this is about as good as compatibility gets with this layout. You can do ISO, split backspace, stepped, unstepped caps, split left shift, as well as, you know, three full-fledged bottom row options, including the split space. Can't really ask for a whole lot more than that. The group I opened on the 3rd, and it was going to be open for 2 weeks after that, so my basic mental math tells me that this will end somewhere on April 17th. So you still have about 8 days left to get in on this. And this is something I actually like quite a bit. So obviously we've seen a lot of designers lately start to structure their colorways a little bit more. So that instead of offering, you know, one color that the consumer chooses, now you kind of have designs like colorways that are contrasted or you know, matched to choose from. So obviously we have Stormtrooper, Ocean, Evangelion, etc., etc. And this actually is an awesome table that breaks down exactly which color each part is going to be. He even has a little legend here. So A stands for anodization, E stands for electrophoresis. So you can tell exactly what type of finish and what color it's going to be for each single part in the kit, for each colorway that you choose. So I like seeing that a lot, that because sometimes it gets a little confusing, a little convoluted if they're offering a lot of options and all of them have 2, 3, 4 colors per option. So I like seeing this. I hope this kind of is a trend that takes off for interest checks and or group buys. And yeah, I like seeing that.
Yeah, the other cool thing about it as well is that they've also got the Schrodinger option. So this is where you don't know what you get until you open the box. So you can tick that option, you can pick to have the Schrodinger colorway, and you're going to get something that you don't know until it turns up, which I absolutely love. I think it's a great idea. If I was going to pick one of these up, that would be my choice for colorway. If I didn't pick the Eva one, because I love the Eva theme. I don't know what Evangelion is, but I've always liked the purple and the green colors. So I would pick that colorway. But if I wasn't picking that, I would definitely go for the Schrodinger one. One of the big things that I tend to do when I join group buys these days is try not to pick a color and then tell the group buy runner to give me what they think is the right color, because I have so many different boards. I feel like if I just chose, I'd just choose the same thing all the time, so it's nice to have something a little bit different. I know it's an anime, but I don't know. I've not watched it. I don't know the story behind it.
I think it's on Netflix right now if you wanted to watch it.
Oh, right, okay. Maybe I will. I really should watch some of these anime, because it's so important to the community. And
lately,
I don't get so much.
Yeah, right?
It's huge.
Although I will say, and I might get flack for this, but I think Evangelion is a little overrated.
Right, okay. All I know is I like the colorway. That's all I can say, because that's why I bought the Canoe Gen 2 in that color as well.
Yeah. Regardless, this is looking like a pretty nice group buy at a pretty nice price, so that's pretty awesome. I'm looking forward to seeing people get these in. I won't be able to afford it still, sadly, but if I could, I probably would buy one. To be honest, I like the design that much, so we'll have to wait and see some nice build pictures and build streams coming up.
Yeah, absolutely. If anyone buys a Schrodinger and they want me to unbox it on stream and do a full stream, I would be down for that, because that'd be a great stream.
How many people do you think are going to choose that option? Do you think that's going to be a popular option? I mean, when people are spending $300-$500 on a keyboard, I feel like most people in our community really want that fine-tuned color control.
Yeah, I think there'd be more than what you suspect, to be honest. I think most people are going to pick a color that they know works for them, and I think that will be very subjective, and people go for, you know, the Stormtrooper black and white or the Eva, whatever tickles their fancy. But I reckon there's a good 10% of the population out there that would like to do this. So I kind of want to do something similar with the Lodestone when we run the Lodestone group buy. Well, hint here that if we offer a kind of unknown option, which we are planning to do, it won't be aluminium, but that's all I'll say. And the response to that has been really positive. About 30% of people who've responded on that have said that that's the option they would pick. They want to be surprised when it turns up. So I wouldn't be surprised if, when people actually come to putting the money down on this, about 10% end up going for that. If it's more, I'd be surprised. If it's less, I'd be surprised. But about 10% is where my money would be.
Gotcha. All right. Well, it'll certainly
be interesting. It's a great idea. Would you not do it, Brian? Would you buy something without colors?
I would do it. But I think that I am a little different from other people when it comes to colors, because even with key sets, like, I really don't care about key set colorways anymore, honestly. It's what I care about is typing on, you know, a profile and a material that I'm comfortable with and that, you know, might benefit or accent the board in some positive way. I don't really care about colors anymore. I really don't. Like, I just don't. Like, I use muted Honeywell in, like, white on black on basically everything, because I just don't care. I like the more neutral stuff. I like the more classic, iconic stuff. And a lot of the fancier, more brightly vivid sets are always not usually for me. With that said, I'm in the minority, and I don't want or expect anyone to feel the same way. Because I'd rather care about the colors more than I do right now, and I used to, but I just kind of got burnt out now that we have so many sets running.
It feels
less personal and less impactful, because now it's just like, oh, what key set am I using today? And then now, you know, you get 40 interest checks in a month, and it's like, okay, I don't care about that anymore. Let me buy this new set. It seems like we just move on so quickly from key sets and colorways just because we have so many that come out every single month. Like, we have 14 key sets this week alone on the dock, interest checked in group buy. Like, crazy.
It's huge.
Crazy. Like, you start to care so much less about sets when you have dozens of them shoved down your throat every single month.
What I will say for that, though, is that I've become more picky about what I buy. At one point, I would buy most key sets, even if I wasn't a huge fan of them, just because it was nice to have them. Now, it's got to the point in the hobby where very, very few people can actually buy every key set that comes out, if anyone. You know, I don't think anyone does that anymore. I certainly don't know of anyone does it. But it has made me really pick and choose which key sets I want to buy. At one point, I would have bought most key sets or a lot of key sets, and now I tend to buy maybe one or two a month and be really selective about what I do pick. So I think you're right. I think that has changed. But I think I'm getting less picky about boards. So that I find that most of my boards are either grey, silver, or black. and I want to branch out from that. And he says that with the bright orange board behind him and all that other kind of stuff. But I kind of want to branch out from that and buy different colors. So not knowing what color I'm going to get is kind of like a really big draw for me from a keyboard perspective. But I kind of understand your point on the keyset perspective.
Yeah. I mean, this is my personal thoughts. Again, I don't want anyone feeling like that because I don't even want to feel like that. I want to be more interested in keyset colorways, but it's just hard for me when you don't really have time to care about any of them because they're just coming out at such a high frequency.
Sure.
Aside, let's continue on with our news doc because, again, it is quite lengthy today. And this next topic is actually kind of interesting to me. I feel like when we checked out the interest check, I didn't care a whole lot for this. But now that we have a little bit more of specs and the group buy has started, then I feel
I know
like
why you like this.
So, anyways, let's just talk about. I'm trying to find. I think there's renders in here somewhere, right? I could have swore there's.
Yeah, there is.
Galleries somewhere.
There is. Just scroll.
Why are all these pictures broken for me?
I don't know, but they're not broken for me. Refresh your page. Refresh your page.
Geek Hack, please. Oh no.
Just while I'm waiting for you to fix that, Mechs on Deck do say Jay's beard is better than Quaken's beard. Don't at me. Well, I agree. Thank you very much. Mine is growing in thick and full these days. So yeah, instead of it being neat and trim, it's growing thick and full.
Okay, I don't know why these pics are all of a sudden not loading for me now. They were for me earlier, but now they're not. I don't know. Maybe it's like a Geek Hack thing, or maybe I'm just.
I think you need to refresh your page.
I did maybe. Three times already. I'll do it a fourth time here, and we'll see what happens. But, yeah. I click on them to expand them, but they don't actually load. They just give me an infinite loading loop for presumably ever. Unfortunate. Oh, okay. Someone linked the Reddit page. I'm gonna use that instead.
Nice. Rechap, thank you very much, dude. Thank you.
Hey, that works. Perfect. All right. So, I haven't actually read the Reddit thread. I've only read the Geek Hack one, but I assume it'll actually contain the same information. So let me run through a couple specs for you here, as well as some pictures. So aluminum case, 7-degree typing angle. Your case color options are going to be black, gray, silver, navy, and e-white. Your plate options are going to be teal aluminum, clear PVD brass, and black palm. So very interesting trio of plate options there. Plates are going to be available in both universal or fixed Onzi 7U bottom row. Which is a nice touch. There's not going to be any PCB in this group buy, but it does fit all the usual suspects for your 60% PCB. So your DZ60, your WT60Ds, your your ZL60s, you name it. It probably fits it as long as it's a standard 60. The overall build weight of this is somewhere around 2 pounds, so about 900 grams. And the MOQ is going to be 125. So this is also I'm going to get to the pictures, sorry guys, but the gasket mounting is pretty interesting in this as well. So it's kind of like a bottom mount, but it's going to actually use pour-on washers, both above and below, presumably it looks like, for the bottom mounting. So bottom mounting kind of where the plate screws into the bottom of the case, but normally it's not like a tray mount. It's it'll have mounting points around the edge. So that's what you get here, and you're going to get the pour-on gaskets here. So it's effectively a bottom gasket mount in a way. And the reason why this is interesting is because the base kit price starts at $140. $140 for a gasket-mounted metal case. And I mean, while the board might not be insane, there's obviously not a whole lot of design, as you can see from the pictures. It looks very similar to something like even the Gasket 00, which kind of had a similar approach where it, you know, you cut out a lot of the frills, the bells, the whistles, and the overly designed stuff, and you just kind of left with, you know, a two-piece case with some kind of gasket mounting solution and, you know, a good price. And I think that's kind of what's happening here as well.
Do you know what it reminds me more of? It actually reminds me more of the IDB60. So the IDB60 in group buy with a PCB was only $135 in the group buy. I know the aftermarket was a little bit more expensive and the extra was a little bit more expensive because of all the issues with the group buy. But yeah, so it reminds me more of that, especially because that was also O-ring mounted. These are pour-on gaskets, so very similar to the O-rings, probably a little bit more premium with the pour-on. And, you know, it kind of felt very, very, very similar, or it feels very similar to me in kind of its style, its layout. It's very much, you know, a rectangle. It's a plain rectangle, you know, no frills, as you said before. But it really reminds me of that, trying to go for a really low price to really push that kind of low price point. But even without a PCB, $140 is pretty much a steal these days for a solid aluminium case, including a plate as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can actually, for only $10 more per part, you can actually get a brass plate and e-white finish on this as well. So lots of options there. Here's the problem, though. MOQ was 125, and it sold out instantly, basically. It went very, very fast, so I don't think this is actually even available anymore, but I would assume
It's
this would
not.
run again due to popularity, because come on, that price point. The specs may be basic, but it's pretty darn solid for the price point, and I feel like a lot of people are going to be wanting stuff like this, because this is the kind of area of the community that I really enjoy, that kind of like sub $200 custom world. Things where you have that Clippa kit that we saw from Mechanus recently, very well priced. You know, the IDB60, and then now the
You
Hex
said it
36.
right.
What?
You said it right for a change.
Said what were they?
You said Clipper instead of
Oh,
Clipe.
I've been trying to get better at it. I really have been trying
Yeah,
to get better at it.
well done. You got it right. Yeah, it's good.
It's hard, man. It's hard. 'Cause I've been saying Clippa like for so long, man. So long. Regardless, I'm a little bummed I missed out on this. And hopefully in the future I can pick one of these up because it looks pretty good for the price.
Yeah, if the finish comes out as well as the look it looks in the prototypes, then yeah, it's great for the price. I think it'll do well if it runs again. I think we've already seen that it's done well once anyway. So yeah, I think it's great to have options at this lower end of the and I say lower end of the budget price range. I mean, nothing's really budget in this hobby, we know that. But for a fully custom keyboard, $200 is kind of like that benchmark price for me. Anything below that is definitely in the budget range, and I hate to call it that. Anything kind of above that starts to get more and more pricey
Budget
as you
doesn't
go up.
mean
But
bad. Let's clear that up right now
no,
because
yeah, and
I've
that's
had
what I'm
people get
not.
mad at us because that's what they're assuming. Budget does not
Yeah.
mean bad. You can still have like really good value parts that are cheap.
Yeah, right. Like I said before, the IDB60, it was a great board for $135. That is a bargain of a board, and this is going to follow in that footsteps. It's a great idea. I know there's been more premium boards that have kind of tried to keep the price low, like the GSKT and things like that. But I think the more projects we have like this in the community, the better.
Yeah, I agree. And the plate even has relief cuts on it as well. So like the plate actually has a decent amount of design to it, it seems. So I don't know. I really like this, and I'm kind of bummed I missed out on it. But hopefully they'll run it again. I will definitely try to pick one up and do some kind of review for it because this is just too interesting for 140 bucks. I mean, even after shipping, and then you add, let's say you spend, you know, $30, $35 on a PCB. Then maybe you get some milky top black bottom Gaterons for, you know, 20 bucks or
15
whatever.
cents a switch,
Yeah, and then you know all of a sudden you only paid $200 and you have, you know, basically a full keyboard minus the caps. And I mean, you have a lot of reasonably priced cap sets out there these days, so I mean, you can really get
Yeah, you
away
could get
with.
that $24 ABS cherry keycap blanks from
Yeah,
keyed-up company
and
guys
at the
for
end of
that,
the day, you're spending 225 bucks and you got like a fully built custom gasket mounted keyboard. Like, that's not bad.
Yeah, or you could for $60 you could go to KBD Fans and get the EPBT ABS caps. I know they're not amazing, but they're great for the price, right? You said
Yeah.
they're pretty good for the price. You're pretty confident with them, so yeah.
For the price, yeah. I mean, obviously they have some issues, but you know, a lot of other products do as well. But we're not gonna get to that now. But regardless, yeah, this was looking pretty cool, and I'm glad it went as well as it did because that makes me believe that they will try to run this again. Anyways, let's move on to our next topic here, which is something we actually forgot last week. So I did add it to the doc this week. But this is the group buy for the Canon 60. And this is a rather interesting keyboard. So let me just talk about some of the specs here. It is going to be a tray mount design, all things considered. It's effectively going to be a brass housing that is encased, as you can see in this picture, with clear polished acrylic, which is kind of interesting. And it's also going to feature a brass plate as well, PVD coated in your choice of gold or rose gold. I'll show you the pictures in a moment, but they are going to be using magnets to attach as many of the parts as they can. So the only screws that you have here are actually the ones that fasten the plate PCB assembly to the tray on the inside of the case. So it is effectively like a brass tray mount keyboard that's encased in acrylic at this point, which is kind of interesting. They are going to be using steel blocks, which you can kind of see here. And it looks like, from what I've been reading, they have kind of a multitude of options. So depending on how you angle the blocks, you can achieve an angle of 3 degrees, 5 degrees, or 7 degrees, which is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. Or you could forego them if you like the flat keyboard experience. That's totally fine as well. The kind of badge, I'm not really going to call it a weight, it's more of an accent, but it is kind of a brass piece here that is just kind of a music note. And this exploded view here, he actually has a lot of other kind of things going on, but I don't know if those are actually going to follow over to the actual design or not, because this seems a little bit more current at this point. The overall weight, once built, is 2.5 kilograms, which is about 5.5 pounds or more. So definitely, that's about the same weight, if not heavier, than a fully built Fjell. I think a Fjell clocks in around 5 pounds, 4 ounces. So this one definitely not a light 60%. This group buy does end April 18th, and the base kit without a PCB is $325. So it is not that cheap. I feel like this board might struggle to sell, because I feel like people generally have trouble spending this much on tray mount boards in our community. Not to say that tray mount is necessarily bad, but I think the general mindset these days is, tray mount shouldn't cost this much. And just had the Fjell run, which was, the Fjell is still quite a bit cheaper than this even, but
The interesting thing is, as well, is there's a lot going into this design, like, you know, having that kind of tray case and then having the whole kind of acrylic housing around it. There's a lot going into that. There's a lot of machining. There's a lot of cuts for magnets and holdings together. You know, there's a lot of different parts that plug in, and effectively you're just taking a standard tray mount case and putting all of that around it. You could have done some really, really interesting and cool stuff with the mounting styles for this. You could have done, you know, almost like a PCB tab mount, like the IWB60 we talked about a few times already. You could have done something like you could have even done it top mount, or you could have done it plate mount, you could have done it bottom mount. There's so many different things you could do with this really, really easily with just some slight tweaks to the design, that it feels weird that they did pick to go with tray mount for this one, given the fact that the community tends not to like the tray mount feel at that kind of price point. As you said, you know, tray mount is very much seen to be a kind of a starter way to get into the hobby rather than one of the more premium options, and as you start to move towards those premium prices, it is kind of strange that they didn't pick up on that. But I do think this looks kind of interesting. I kind of don't dislike the idea of it. It kind of makes sense to me to do this kind of thing. It's a unique take on a design. It's something a little bit different. I think it's a good idea. I'm not particularly in love with the sound tests, but I don't think they're filmed particularly well. And of course, sound tests are notoriously unreliable as well. But I was listening to those earlier on when we started to add this to the news doc. But I think it'll do okay. I'm just not sure if it's for me. I think they could have done some more interesting stuff in there with the mounting methodology. But the actual design and the idea behind it is quite cool. Putting that kind of acrylic case around it is kind of cool.
Yeah, I think visually it actually looks all right, and I do like the concept. I like the idea, but it's unfortunate that it's priced this high. Not necessarily because it's costing them much less to do. I assume it's probably priced fairly accurately. It's just a little high for the rest of the specs. I feel like the kind of people that are going to buy this product are going to buy it specifically for the aesthetics and probably nothing else. I'm sure it's going to sell some units based on that alone. But I feel like overall this board might not be as popular. What do you guys in chat think? Is this board really cool? Is this board for you? Are you going to potentially buy one of these? Or is this kind of a little silly at this price point? I want to hear your thoughts. Also, I like GMK Phantom on this too. This render, or not render, but this picture makes me really happy.
I mean, it's not a bad looking board, right? It looks okay. I don't think it looks terrible. You could do some really cool stuff. Instead of doing that tray inside as brass, you could do it with anodized aluminium and all that kind of stuff. And I think they're doing different color options. But there's so much you could do with that. You could add tinted acrylic to it and all sorts of different things. You know, there's a lot you can kind of do with that, and I think it's kind of interesting. I definitely think there's potential here. I just think the big downside for me is that whole tray mount piece, but I'd love something like a purple aluminium insert or something for this. I think that'd look great.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see what kind of cost savings you might get if you forego things like PVD and brass and maybe try to target it towards closer to a $200 price point, maybe.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge you're going to have as well is with all the different color combinations, that's a lot of different parts and a lot of different colors to try and manage and keep the same and match and all of that kind of stuff. So it does worry me that there's so many different choices and options in there for the group buy. I think when I was looking at it, there was what, 20 different overall looks that you could go with if you pick different parts. That's a lot of inventory to manage.
Yeah. I guess we'll have to see how it goes, but the group buy is currently open, so if this is your thing, then now's a good time to get in on it. Here's the supported layouts, by the way. Pretty
Yeah,
much
it's pretty much everything,
it
right?
supports pretty much. Yeah, I mean, it's a universal plate like you saw, which is, you know, there's pros and cons to that. Obviously, universal plates tend to sound very weak, and they leak sound quite a bit. And they might not feel as consistent, but the trade-off is they support a lot of layouts. So depending on who you are, that could be really good or really bad for you. I tend to prefer
Yeah.
fixed plates, which I think is kind of
And
where the community is mostly right now. But I understand that in a tray mount, it's probably better to go universal.
well, the good thing about this is it's a standard tray mount plate, right? So you could go and buy one of the standardized offerings that are fixed as a tray mount plate and put that in this board. That's just going to fit just fine. It's a standard 60% tray mount case in that respect. So you could even just buy a case and put a 60% build that you've already got into this. So whatever plate and PCB you've already got lying around should, in theory, fit into this, whether it's USB-C or USB mini. The USB port's widened enough to fit those, so you should be able to just drop a build in.
Yep, definitely. All right, guys. So that is currently running, and it does end on the 18th of this month. Let's move on to our next topic here. And this one kind of came out of left field, I feel like. This is kind of interesting. So this is Norbauer decided he wanted to do a polycarbonate heavy six. He's calling it the Urbi et Orbi edition. I kind of researched what that was before, but I still don't entirely understand it. But effectively, this is the polycarbonate version of the Heavy 6. So, a lot of you might know if you're familiar with Norbauer products, he recently did a newer round of the Norba Force cases, and polycarbonate was one of the options there. Some pictures have been floating around the community, and you know, everyone seems to pretty much love the way that the polycarbonate Norba Force looks, and I think that maybe kind of pushed him in the direction of launching the Heavy 6 polycarbonate version. So this is pretty interesting. So if you're unfamiliar with what the Heavy 6 is, it's basically a replacement case for your Leupold FC660C Topra keyboards. So you basically harvest the internals out of that, you take the plate PCB switch assembly out of that, and you transplant it into a case like this, and boom, you kind of have a pseudo custom Topra depending on how you look at it. And like all Norbaforce, or not, sorry, not Norbaforce, but all Norbauer products tend to be incredibly top tier. His attention to detail and his level of QC is pretty much unmatched. Even if a case has like a scratch, like he won't send it out. He'll just keep it and take the loss. So, you know, due to that and due to the fact that he usually has the manufacturing and finishing done in the U.S., the price tends to be a little on the high side. So, as you can see here, $490 version, and obviously that doesn't include your Leupold FC660C. So, this is not for the faint of heart or the faint of wallet. But if you like Norba Force products or Norbauer products rather, and you like polycarbonate, this could totally be for you.
Yeah, there's a couple of things as well that's interesting about this. So the terminology that he's given for the name of this, the Urbi et Orbi, it's around just for those that you are interested. It's Latin, but it goes back to the Pope that gives blessings at certain times of the year. So there's usually three different occasions where the Pope would give this Urbi et Orbi blessing. One is Easter, which it's Easter right now, which kind of fits the theme for the board. The other two are Christmas or when a new Pope is elected as well. So it's very much an apostolic blessing. That's where it comes from. There's a lot more to it than that as well. So I think there's some interesting things. If you want to go and read it, there's probably a good Wikipedia page on there if you're interested. Or there'll be some other Google translations as well. Moving on to the board though itself, there's a couple of things that are kind of interested about this as well. So if you want to buy a heavy six case with this as well, he does have a custom carry case. You can get a 20% bundle discount if you buy both the case and the board itself at the same time. So if you want to pick one of those up, you will get a slight discount. and that's applied automatically when you check out too. The other interesting thing as well is that the finish he's gone for on the polycarbonate is slightly different to what's on most boards. So he's actually going for a less aggressive blasting, so it's much finer detailed blasting, and that means that it's going to change the finish from a lot of what polycarbonate boards look like. He also has a video on how to maintain frosted polycarbonate. I do express that you go and watch that, because even if you're not interested in how to maintain polycarbonate, the production quality that Nobile puts on his videos is second to none, and it's definitely worth watching from that prospect alone.
Yeah, absolutely. Norbauer's quality is pretty much second to none when it comes to virtually everything he does in his life.
I've dropped a link for the video in there as well, if anyone wants to go watch that. Nice. Also of note, you should also go and watch the video for the previous Heavy Six, where he told people, gave people an instructional video on how to wax their keyboards as well. That was really good.
Oh, yeah, it was fantastic. Watching. Also, a quick note on these carrying cases that you get at a discount for this purchase. These are amazing. I've had the pleasure of seeing and using one of these in person when I was with Norbauer last summer, and oh my god, these cases are fantastic. The silver here, this is actually a metal weave, so like that's actually metal. It's nuts, the quality on this particular item. But they are not cheap either. But that kind of reflects the whole process behind Norbauer's pretty much everything in this community.
Yeah, calf skin for the handles and stuff like that. I mean, they are genuinely lovely.
He goes for the best of the best for everything, whether it's materials or finishings, and he does pretty much everything exclusively in the U.S. now. He's sworn off things like anodization because it's not consistent enough for him. And he refuses to put out products that are like not A stock or like actual like A plus perfection. So
yeah. He even quotes our very own Captain Schwa, who's one of our longest subscribers on this, and says outrageously high quality. So Captain Schwa, well done for getting a notification and a quote and a shout on Nobauer's store.
Where is that? I haven't even seen that yet.
If you go on the key brief, if you go on the bag, key brief 60, and then it's just above the video showing how they make the bag. It says outrageously high quality, Captain Schwa on Geekak.
All right, cool. That is cool. All right, let's move on to our next topic here, which is an interesting one. This is another tray mount case here. So this is a group buy for the Velocifier X FOK 64, 60% keyboard. And I know this is probably not going to be for most of you, but I feel like we'll give it a little bit of service anyways. So.
The name just made me chuckle.
Yeah, well, so Velocifier is a keyboard OEM. In fact, I even have a Velocifier 10 keyless keyboard in my closet right now. $30 shipped mechanical keyboard from Amazon. I bought it, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago because I wanted to know how bad a $30 mechanical keyboard could be. And the answer is quite bad, to be totally honest with you. But it looks like they kind of want to take a slightly further step into something a little bit more mid-range, perhaps. And this is kind of what they came up with here. So I'll go through some of the specs and the pictures here. It is going to be a tray mount case. It's going to have a 5-degree angle. It's going to be available in a couple colors, midnight blue and pearl white, both of which I believe are e-coating or electrophoresis. There is going to be a slot within the case for your Bluetooth battery, if that's your thing. And the PCB that it's going to be coming with is going to be QMK with an ONSI layout. However, if you notice this layout, and I did check some of the other pictures, and I believe the PCB is exclusive to this layout. It is not hot swap. However, it forces the 60% arrow keys here. So yep. that's a little unfortunate depending on who you are, but it could be workable depending on who you are as well. So the case itself is going to be $120. And if you want it with a plate and a PCB for the kit, it's going to be $170. So not terribly expensive, all things considered. But very basic kind of tray mount case here at a not too high price. But a silly layout depending on who you are.
Yeah, I was going to say the layout is not for me. Just the whole right-hand side of the spacebar just looks really, really weird for me. Having just effectively 10 1U keycaps across the two rows, I just feel really strange. But they've done that to try and keep it as close to correct stagger as possible, and add the arrows in at the same time as well. So I can see why they've done it. It's not for me. It isn't that layout. It's not something I would particularly choose, but you know, hey, some people use it and some people love that layout, I'm sure.
Yeah, this layout, this particular layout, is actually kind of common over in the Eastern communities. I know over in China, 60% with arrow keys was a huge layout for years and years and years. A lot of people like that, but in the Western communities, people tend to shy away from it. People tend to not like it as much. I kind of agree. I don't really like the look or the feel of dedicated arrow keys on a 60%, but some people are pretty into it, so...
I think that's fair enough. What I will say is I kind of don't dislike the design, though. There isn't a ton of different pictures here, but what I do kind of like is the actual design itself. So I think first and foremost, kind of like the rounded corners, the chunky bezels and stuff like that, it's kind of okay. It looks good, especially for something at this kind of price range. You know, I don't dislike that. It reminds me a lot of other boards, and I've always been a big fan of a wedge underneath the board as well, so you can kind of have that floating look and get your fingers underneath and pick it up. So I don't dislike the looks of this particular board. I think it looks far better in the white than it does in the blue, although that blue is a great color. I think paler colors tend to suit that kind of rounded corner design a little bit better than darker colors do, but that's just my personal preference, and I think it's okay. I think it would have been interesting if they would have offered different PCBs and opportunities to utilize different PCBs and layouts, because at the end of the day, it is just a tray mount at the end of the day. So would have been nice to have seen that.
Yeah. Regardless of how you feel about the layout, the plate is actually fixed, so that's kind of cool as well. So a little bit better feel and more sound consistency as well. But you know, that's obviously if you're a fan of this particular layout. I actually like the midnight blue. Honestly, I think I like it more than the white.
I like the color. I just don't particularly like it on this board. I think the color's great, but I'm not a fan of it on this board. One of the things that does jump out at me though as well that's really strange about this board, and I don't know if anyone else noticed this, but I haven't seen many people talk about it either, but the plate itself, it looks like it uses plate mount stabilizers. Okay, not the greatest, but that's, you know, it is what it is. You look at the PCB and you look at the ANSI enter, you look at the backspace and a few other areas around there, and you think, well, actually, I can see stabilizer holes. Only there isn't always stabilizer holes for all of the keys. So even if you wanted to use stabilized keys on this board, you can't always. So the left shift, for example, there are no stabilizer holes for that in the PCB. You have to use the plate mount one for that. Whereas for the, I think it's the ANSI enter and the backspace maybe, or maybe it's just the ANSI enter, there are stabilizer holes for it as well. So it's kind of weird that the PCB is really fixed in terms of what you can do, but then they've got PCB mount stabilizers in some places and only plate mount options in others, which is kind of strange.
Looking at it now, I don't even see the stabilizer holes on the PCB for normal backspace. But it's
yeah, so it's missing from backspace. So
you have to use plate mount stabilizers for some of the spots.
Which is weird, because there's definitely stabilizers there for the ANSI enter.
I see it for the enter, but that's it. The spacebar and the enter. Backspace does not have holes for it, nor does left shift.
Yeah, it's very strange. Very strange.
But of course, the plate does look like it supports the plate mount stabilizers, anyways. So that's interesting. That's interesting.
I think it'll do well in the community. I think there's people that want this kind of board at this kind of price. So I think it'll do okay. I think it's very much in kind of like keeping with kind of what I'd see as KBD fans kind of pricing, that kind of thing. You know, I think what did you say base kit was? $170 US, and it's just $120 US if you want the case, I think you said.
Yep, that's correct.
But for that case at that $120, I think that's all right. That's pretty good.
Yeah. Cool. So we'll have to see how it goes. Let's move on to our next topic, though, which is actually kind of in a similar vein here. This is the Ryloo Studio, quote-unquote, Hello, M0110 Mechanical Keyboard Kit. So this isn't the first time or the second or probably even the third time at this point that we've seen a custom that's kind of been based on the theme of the Apple M0110, which is obviously a very classic and iconic keyboard in our community. And there's even still, I think that the primary one is ongoing, right? The group buy, the really popular one for the really high-end custom one that started in 2017. A lot of people are still waiting on that one. But You know, maybe if you want something that is presumably maybe not quite as nice, but still has some decent features set for the price, this could potentially be for you. A couple specs here. So the housing itself is going to be aluminum. You're going to have your choice between standard or HHKB tops. It's going to have a 6-degree angle. Top-mounted plate, aluminum universal plate. PVD brass weight. The PCB is going to have QMK, USB-C, and per-key RGB. It's also incredibly Swiss cheese, as you can see from this picture here. So that might not be for you. The weight overall is going to be about 4 pounds, or around 1.8 kilograms. And, the colors are going to be e-white, gray, red, blue, light green, and dark green. Interesting that they have two green options here, but price is going to be $250, or, for me, it was about $283 after taxes and shipping, here in the US. So yeah, this is, potentially for some people out there. Universal plate, not my favorite. Super Swiss cheese plate, also not my favorite. But at the end of the day, it's a top mount custom for $250, and it has brass parts, so the price seems to be reasonable.
Yeah, I think the pricing's okay. I think a couple of things about this for me. We've seen a lot of, as you said, Brian, we've seen a lot of clones for this particular vintage board, and I absolutely adore the vintage boards. You know, a lot of people know that I like the vintage stuff. The Apple board's not... withstanding, you know, they're big favorites of mine. So I don't mind the styling of this thing. It looks okay. I think there's been better interpretations, but I don't mind this. In terms of the mount, top mount is you know, perfectly fine. I disagree on having the side tabs for the top mount as well. I think it's perfectly fine just running across the two top edges. Putting it on the side sides also makes it a little bit more stiff. But that being said, you could quite easily not use those if you wanted to, or you could dremel them off or whatever, I guess, as well. Interestingly, on the PCB as well, a couple of things to call out on this. So the PCB, as you said, is a bit Swiss cheesy. It does support a ton of different layouts, which in itself isn't too bad, and for this kind of price range, that's fine. One of the really interesting things about this PCB, though, is that it is uses a daughter board. So I can't remember if there's a split view of the board anywhere. But it uses a daughter board, but it doesn't use a JST connector, which is what we usually use. It actually uses a ribbon cable for connecting to the daughter board, which is kind of interesting, kind of unique, and not something we see very often. So it'll make absolutely no difference to how the board works. But
is that an actual Apple logo on the HHKB version?
I haven't seen that.
It's on picture 13 of 19.
Yes, it is. Wow.
Can they do that? I'm trying to find a better picture of it. But that seems like a no-no.
As Ungodly Design says, if you don't get caught, yeah, I guess. But that seems like it's not something that Drop would want to promote.
That's a little questionable. Yeah, I don't know if that's going to fly. But obviously Drop will have to deal with that.
I would suspect even on the HHKB version that will not actually be there in production. It may have been there for a prototype if someone was doing a personal one-off or something like that, but I would be very surprised if that makes it through.
In which case, either way, even if that's the scenario here, Drop should not be promoting this picture like this.
No. Absolutely not. I suspect that is included completely by mistake and not intended to be there at all. Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know. That aside, we'll obviously let them deal with that, but check out the supported layouts. Look at how Swiss cheesy the PCB and plate need to be to support... It was a 6 different bottom rows. 6 different bottom rows here, including 2 that offer split spacebar. That seems unnecessary, I gotta admit. How many people are actually gonna use a lot of these? Let's be real.
Realistically, there's going to be 2 main choices and then a small percentage of people that use the most popular split spacebar option. And I think that's broadly where it's going to be. You know, I think there's the standard 6.25U bottom row, which we see right at which is the top green option. And then the very bottom green option, those are going to be the 2 main options because that's the standard 7U bottom row that you can use for HHKB and all of the other options for the layouts and tops. Everything else is kind of going to be hit or miss, and I think that maybe one of those split spacebar options should be supported if you want to offer that, and you could get rid of 4 of the choices in the middle there.
All right, so as if I wasn't already confused enough, Check out, let me try to find this picture again, sorry, 14 or 15 in there on after, actually. You can see, actually, it looks like a real picture, not a render. You can see the PCB in there. Every spot has a PCB mount stabilizer. But obviously, we know, based on the picture that they provided us, that the PCB should not support PCB mount stabilizers in the backspace and left shift locations. But here they are on
that
this
was,
PCB.
That was the previous board.
Oh, was it? Okay, I'm stupid then. Don't listen to me then. I'm getting them mixed.
It's support stabilizers everywhere.
To me, they're basically the same board, because I'm not really interested in either of them. So, all right. Well, anyways, let's at least all agree that the PCB is about as Swiss cheese as it can get, and it seems unnecessary. Can we agree on that?
Yeah, yeah. The only thing that would tempt me on this one is the fact that I like vintage boards, and the only other interesting thing about it for me is the fact that it uses a ribbon cable for the USB daughter board.
Why does it say hello on the bottom?
Branding, I guess. Right. And I can actually tell you why it says hello on there. So when Apple introduced the Lisa, which is one of their earlier computers, it actually wrote hello on the screen, and it actually had a voice thing. A little bit like Siri or Cortana or something. It actually spoke to you and said that as well. So it's very much the Apple kind of text thing. It's just paying homage to it. So I can tell you absolutely why it's there, but I think it's just for branding.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's kind of cool. At least it keeps it somewhat thematic in that sense.
Yeah. It's actually, funny enough, that's actually probably a better thing to spend your time doing than looking at this board, is going and watching the Apple introduction of the Apple Lisa. It was great video.
Yep, so that's available on Drop right now for anyone that is interested for 4 days remaining there. So there you go. Let's move over to the keyset world. And like I've been complaining this whole time, we have a lot of keysets to go over this week. So we'll try to rapid fire it a little bit here. Starting us out with the interest check for GMK Ishtar. You'll notice a theme here. We have a lot of anime or anime-esque themed key sets this week, which seems to kind of be the trend moving forward. But this one is based off the everyone's favorite goddess Ishtar from Fate Go. I'm actually not totally familiar with the Fate Go series, so this is totally out of my realm of expertise, but he does give a reference image there, which I presume is the character in question. So, moving over to the actual set, how do you feel about this?
I mean, so first thing that jumps out to me is a Yukari. So I know we've got Depleted Vespin, he'll correct me if I get this slightly wrong. But there is only support for US ISO in the base kit. Even though there is a 1.25U shift for split left shift, there is no 1U key that I can see for row 4. So it doesn't actually support European ISO layouts, let's put it that way, but it only supports US ISO, and it has a random 1.25 U shift key that would only otherwise be used on 40s. Other than that, the kit breakdown is pretty much okay. It covers most things that you'd want to cover, HHKB, a few other things. The renders here not looking the best. There's a couple of legends that don't look like they're consistent with GMK Legends, but that's just kind of my feel for it, and profile as well. Colors wise, I don't like the yellow accent. I think the black, red, and cream is okay, but it's not for me.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to agree on this. The colors are not really for me, and judging by this reference image, they don't really seem to match up that well either.
I think it's a brighter white.
Even to my colorblind eyes, yeah. Like, I don't understand how, obviously, I'm mousing over her clothing here. This doesn't look cream to me. That looks much whiter. And I feel like these alpha keys are effectively more of a cream. So I feel like maybe some of the colors need to be changed just a little bit there. There is what he's calling the Kuro add-on kit, which is going to give you the darker colored alphas to match the mods if you're more of a fan of the dual tone look.
Yeah, I mean, it's just red on black at that point. It's just bread, isn't it, at that point? So I not a huge fan of that. Also, just noticed back in the base kit as well, and Ten Strong points out in chat that there's only a 2U key for the zero in the numpad, so the numpad isn't even fully featured there. There is some other keys that I would personally think should be included, but they're not, so it's not great.
Yeah, this seems a little odd. I think the kitting obviously is going to need a little bit of work, and I mean, at least to me, maybe the coloring too. Someone in chat was saying that the colors could be like based on her skin color. I suppose to me that feels like it's reaching. I mean,
yeah, that feels like a bit of a weird way to judge it.
It feels like a weird way to design a set too, because I mean, most time like we've had, this is obviously nothing new. We've had so many sets based on anime colors or anime characters so far, and I don't think we've seen even one of them use colors of the character's skin. It's always been, you know, their outfit, their hair, maybe like, you know, like a weapon they're using or some other kind of something tied in. But interesting. I guess you could be right, whoever that was in chat. Sorry, I forgot the username. But maybe that they are going for kind of a skin tone here, in which case that still doesn't look quite right to me.
Yeah, I feel like that's not right. Which reminds me, 159, when's Jim Kane nude happening? I need that. But yeah, this isn't for me. The colors don't gel well. I don't really get the creamy part of the set. It looked much better as WS1 or WS2. WS1 probably, I think, would be more fit for it. The Dark Alphas just feels like it's kind of, you know, the like Sanctuary Rebirth and Bread sets that we saw in Infinity quite recently, and I think we've seen Demonic as well in GMK before. It kind of looks close to that, and it's not for me either. The novelties I don't get, but I think they're okay. I kind of really dig the two diamond kind of shapes together. I don't know what that's from or what it means, but I kind of dig that keycap. But yeah, other than that, there's nothing here that interests me really.
Yeah, the novelties look fine. I don't understand them because I don't know the source material. It's been on my plan to watch list forever. I haven't actually watched it, so I don't actually understand it. But, I mean, the renders look all right. I don't think the colors are terrible. I think there's definitely potential here, but I think it needs a little bit of work.
Well, yeah.
I like this one that has the really dark lighting, too. I like when people adjust lightings and renders.
Yeah, the renders themselves aren't bad. It's just the keycaps. Later on, I've just scrolled down. I hadn't looked at this before the stream in terms of the rest of the chat, but I've just scrolled down, and the guy behind it does actually do a render for some Hiragana caps because he seems to be trying to give people what they want. Again, they're still keeping that kind of creamy color. Not really for me. It's quite far down. It doesn't really work for me.
Yeah, I gotta agree. I don't know. I'm not going to rant about Hiragana Sublegends, because I do like Hiragana Sublegends. I just think that not every single set needs them, just because they're based on...
Do you know what? I'd rather have Hiragana, Legends as a whole, rather than the Dual Legends. I'd rather
just have those. You know what, Jay? You might like the next topic, then. Which I think we should move over to now, because this interest check clearly needs a little bit more work, but... Definitely wishing this person the best, Bachu, whoever, however you pronounce that. But let's move on to something I know I'm really excited for, and potentially you will be as well. So
okay,
so there's a lot of weird things going on with this right now, but it is labeled as an interest check. But I guess if you want to get realistic, the group buy has technically opened already. More on that in a second. More on that in a second. So this is the interest check slash buy, potentially, for GMK Shoko Second Style. The reason he didn't say Round 2 or V2 or Shoko 2 is actually in line with the game that this is inspired off of. So Second Style is the kind of terminology they use in the game, so he wanted to keep with that theme here and bring you another run of GMK Shoko, which is a set that ran, I think, towards the end of 2018, shipped towards the middle of 2018.
A year ago.
Yeah, you had it at the Summer Seattle meetup last July, and it was lovely. I think the colors worked out really well, and it was honestly a sleeper set. It didn't sell a ton of units at first, but after it shipped, a lot of people wanted it, and the price went way, way, way up on the aftermarket.
With that said, the group buy was open for a long time when it was open. They kept it open to try and hit MOQ for quite a long time. And I'll be honest, I didn't join it at that point. I think I joined it quite late on, right at the very end, just as it was about to close. But I agree when you said it's a sleeper set. I absolutely think it was one of the better sets of last year. I rock it on a board behind me, and I think it looks great as a set. I think it was. I don't get the source material, but as a set, I think it works really, really well.
Yeah, definitely. So I really appreciated the colors. I'm not really familiar with the source material, but I still liked it quite a bit. There have been a couple of changes, though. So I think the kitting structure is a little bit different this time around. I don't remember off the top of my head how it was before. However, one of the bigger changes you might notice is previously he used text plus icon for the mods. Here, he's using icon only for the mods, or at least the non-bottom row mods. So I approve of this because I'm an icon mod kind of guy. So I like this quite a bit. Also note that there are only there are a few kits here, but none of them actually feature Hiragana sublegends. However, base kit does have Latin legend only, which is a nice touch. You can opt for the Hiragana kit, which will give you Hiragana mono legends, as well as a lot of extra keys, including the tab and a 1.75 U right shift here. The inclusion of those, as well as some of these other caps, really means that you can potentially use this set on two different boards if you buy these two kits. So you kind of buy like 1.5 GMK sets and you wind up covering two boards, which is very nice. I like the extra value that provides. I'm glad to see people taking advantage of that. But
fully agree. Fully agree. Big shout out as well, because it even includes enough keys to do ISO, so you could do ISO on two layouts, one with the Latin legends and one with the Hiragana legends. So big shout out to Ray on that one. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And as far as the base kit is concerned, I don't think it gets a whole lot better. This is pretty inclusive here. You have your numpad, you have all your usual 65, 75, you know, Sangon HHKB support. You have full UK ISO coverage in the base kit, as well as so many accents. So I feel like they did a really, really strong job in the base kit. I can't see anything that they're really missing off the top of my head.
No, it's a really solid base kit. Yeah, it's good. It covers pretty much everything. Pretty much everything. There's very little it doesn't cover.
Yeah. Except for someone in the chat pointed out accent escape. You might be right. That might be a mistake. I assume that he would have that in here. It'd be kind of odd.
Yeah, he's the accent escape was in the original set, but there wasn't an alpha colored escape in the original set, if I remember correctly. There is an alpha colored one here, so maybe that's been changed. Yeah, I'll have to double check on my set, but I'm pretty sure that alpha colored escape wasn't in the original.
Yeah. Spears in chat says it's a mistake. So obviously this is, in theory, an interest check, and he does say subject to minor changes. Anyway, so let's get back to the kit breakdown here. Obviously the base kit looking pretty good. We've been over this Hiragana Mono Legend kit, also looks pretty strong. Spacebar kit, that's pretty good as well. You have quite a variety, including the splits, some accents, as well as the Alice B. Then you have the Obscure kit, which is, you know, the 40% kit effectively, and it looks like you have a decent amount of compatibility for a lot of 40s there. Then you have obviously some insanely beautiful render work from Max Surfy, I believe it was. Fantastic renders as usual, and a lot of these are pretty interesting. I don't know if you checked out these renders yet, but like, have you seen the? I think it's the doppelganger that's like coated in ice and has like ice.
Yeah, it looks great, right?
That's really cool. I kind of like the style of these renders.
My favorite one's the 910 one, where you can see it at the bottom corner, because the coffee cup has been used and it's been set down, and it looks quite good. And then also in the phone on that particular one, there's a phone on the desk, and in the reflection of the phone, you can see exactly what the reflected image of what would be on the Mac screen as well at the same time. So that looks really good too. Yeah, some really, really good detailed stuff in there.
Yeah, and if you're curious about the colors, this this particular picture is actually of the previous set. It's not, because this has icon mods. Wait a minute. It says this is a picture. Wait a minute. How the heck does he have icon mods? I'm confused.
The original set has icons.
The original set has icon plus text, right?
Let me go get the board. You're right. It is icon and text. There you go.
That's okay. Yeah. Set. But he says this one's a picture, so I'm assuming that's not supposed to be a render. But this has icon mods.
Oh, there was an icon mod kit in the original group.
Oh, okay.
I clearly didn't get that. I clearly just got the best.
I totally forgot about that. Apparently. Regardless, this picture is fantastic, and it really does show off the colors really well, and why I do believe this was very much a sleeper set. Those blues are absolutely fantastic.
It's a stunning set. It's a great set. It's one of my favorite of last year. Absolutely.
Yeah. So let's talk about what's going on with this set right now, because it's kind of weird. So this set is actually live right now on Kodo. I don't know if it's live on any of the proxies, but it is currently live.
It wasn't when I looked before we went live, so I don't know if it is now, but it wasn't a couple of hours ago.
Yeah. So I'm not entirely sure what's going on there. I feel like it was a little rushed, perhaps, and maybe some of the renders aren't quite in place. I did check at the I'm gonna look over at Kono store right now, actually, just so we can kind of stay updated on this. I don't think it's on their front page here.
No, it's not. You have to go on keycap sets, and then it's about halfway down the page, but it is there.
All right, so yeah, I did look at this earlier. It is up now. You can join it. Price is $140. And he has renders here from the previous run. So he has text icon mods for some of these runs. I don't approve of doing that, to be honest with you. I really wish they swapped over all the renders here just to better... Because the first pick is an incorrect picture of what they're selling.
There's a couple of things that jump out at me on this one. First of all, you can't even get all of the kits that are available in the interest check here. So the mono hiragana set, for example, that's not here. There's only base, space, and obscure. And when you look at it, there's a lot of other things that aren't right. If we talked about that escape key in the base kit and how the fact it was alpha colored rather than accent colored, and that's likely a mistake. A couple of people in chat were talking about how that's likely a mistake, but I'm not sure what grounds that leaves Kona on if they change that now that they've sold that base kit as it's there. So if people buy this and they're buying that base kit, that's what they're expecting to get. If now Kona then updates it based on Ray's kind of input and stuff like that, I don't know what that leaves them on from legal footing. Here in the EU, that would be kind of a big no-no and you'd be expected to recompense your customer for it. I don't know what the rules are in the US on that kind of stuff. It puts the vendor in a very difficult position if you sell something and then change it afterwards. And unless you can have a good reason for doing so, or unless it wasn't something that was predefined beforehand. But when it's something as specific as that, it can leave you on individual footing.
And just to preface this a little bit, this is for the people that always feel like we don't give enough shit to our sponsors. Look at this situation. This is not being handled correctly by Kono. So I will say that publicly, just because I know that some people think that we favor our sponsors, but honestly, I don't. So, yeah, and this is not the first time this has happened. Last time they ran GMK Shoko, they had problems as well. I was talking to the keyset designer before the show today, because I was actually pretty curious about it. And the original GMK Shoko run also had some issues with some of the renders that were pictured. And that's one of the reasons why it struggled to get off the ground. GMK Merlin had the same issue on Kono. They didn't put up all the renders. Some of the renders were wrong. I think some of the kitting was wrong. And we're seeing that again here. And I don't know why they keep doing that. So I think my kind of idea right now is that Kono has quite a few people on staff. And a lot of really smart and cool people. Honestly, they do. But I don't really think very many of them are actual keyboard enthusiasts. At least in the same way that people like us are keyboard enthusiasts. They don't really worry about things like kitting. You know, Hata's busy designing, brand new Switch technology with Kale right now. Like, you know, nobody there is like a keyboard enthusiast in the same sense that we are. And I think because of that, these kind of things can suffer. We don't see the kitting right. We don't see the renders right. The very first picture is from the previous run. All the kits aren't listed here. And it's unacceptable. It really, really is. You can't do that with a $140 GMK set.
Yeah, I completely agree. And the other side of it as well is that the group buy runner didn't even know it was live on Kono at the time. If nothing else, then you need to keep the partners and vendors that you're working with. It's a business endeavor, after all. You need to keep all of the designers, partners, proxies, whatever else you've got in terms of the business in the loop and working together. As part of being, you know, the lead vendor on something and making sure that you're running it to that kind of standard. So I do feel that Kono maybe have dropped the ball on this. Maybe they were excited. Maybe they wanted to get it live. Maybe whatever, a thousand things. But at the same time, they all need to be on the same page. Communication is key in any group buy, and I would expect Kono to really follow that up with the designer and the other vendors and make sure that everyone was on the same page. And it feels like that has been missing. Maybe it's something that's been happening in the background, we're just not aware of it, but it does feel like that's something that's missing.
Yeah, absolutely. So I really think this is unacceptable in Depleted Vespin in chat says Kono needs to get this kind of kinks straightened out. And I totally agree. They don't really have that kind of, you know, super enthusiast tier team member on their team, which is kind of unfortunate. And I feel like if they did have someone, that is part of our kind of enthusiast community there, I think they would probably not run into issues like they are here. And it's kind of unfortunate, but I hope they get it figured out soon, because I'm really curious to see what's going to go on here. I actually want to buy this set. And I don't know if I should join it at this moment because of how it's being handled by Kono. And, like, I don't know. I was talking to the designer before the show today, and, he doesn't really understand what's going on either. It was just a surprise, as much a surprise to him as it was to everyone else. So I wonder if this is going to get taken down, reworked, and then relaunched another time, or if they're just going to roll with it like this.
I really don't know, because the really interesting thing as well is that the actual sale page for the group buy links to Ray's original 2018 Geekhack thread. It doesn't even link to the new one. It doesn't link to the new interest check, even though it uses some of the new renders. It links to the original one. It just feels like there's a lot missing and it's not all tied together quite right. And you know, that's something that I feel that Kona do need to address on here. As much as we love them as sponsors, we need to call out when our sponsors aren't doing the right things and displaying the right behaviors. And right now it feels like they need to have a little bit more clarity around this one for us.
Yeah. Actually, I remember I PM'd Kona's CEO, Andrew, last time when they ran GMK Merlin because of how it was handled. I was like, hey man, like you can't do this. Like, and so we talked about that, and I think we might have to talk to him again, because this is interesting at the very least. And I hope it does get settled, because I do want to buy this set. I really do.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. It doesn't look like it's live on any of the other proxies. I've just been having a look now. But yeah, I do feel that kind of need to fix this.
Yeah. So that's kind of the hope here, and we'll have to wait and see, but hopefully we get more information soon by the end of the day, because this is a weird scenario that shouldn't have happened, and I feel kind of bad for the designer, Ray Sasquatch here.
Yeah,
he should have been more in the loop.
Yeah, absolutely. Communication is key with that kind of thing. And it's a shame, because it's a lovely set. It's one of my favorite sets of last year. I can't sing its praises highly enough. I would absolutely be buying that Hiragana kit, even though I wouldn't buy another base kit, I'll be honest, but I would buy the Hiragana Mono Legends, even though that's not something I usually do, purely because I do really like this colorway and I like this set.
Yeah, absolutely. Also, shout out to Talisman Solutions for gifting a tier one sub to Shoko Ai, who is the designer. I don't think he used to watch the show, but I don't know if he watches it so much anymore. But thank you very much for the gift sub. I also saw all the gift subs that you gave out earlier. I forgot to call those out, but Talisman has finally crossed the 250 gifted sub barrier, now at 251. Wow. So thank you so much for all those gifted subs, man.
That's crazy.
You are actually a top clack hero.
Thank you very much, Tizeman. Shoko's actually in chat. He says that Daily Clack wasn't notified either as well. So he is in chat. So,
yeah, it's really unfortunate, because he shouldn't have to go through this a second time. Like, how do you go through this a second time? Kono's got to fix this. And they got to fix it right. So hopefully we'll get that. Then we'll have some more information on that soon, because I really want this set. It has icon mods. Oh. All right. Anyways, let's move on from that kind of debacle right now. But we definitely wish them all the best, and we hope they get that figured out as soon as possible. All right. Let's move over to the interest check for GMK Skyline, which is kind of, it's not necessarily themed after a Nissan Skyline or Nissan Skyline. If you're
Nissan,
British.
Yes. Yeah.
it's not necessarily themed after the car itself, but more so for this particular picture that this designer, or this user rather, depending on how you want to view it, found on Reddit a while back, and it is a very nice picture, I gotta admit, and he decided to theme a set off of this, so there is that. How do you feel about the colorway on this, because I'm not really sure how
I'll be honest, I love the picture, love the cars. I've never actually owned a Skyline. I've had one of the forerunners to the Skyline, but not an actual Skyline. So I love the car, love the picture, love the source material. Not so much in love with the set. It's probably the weaker of the Blind Assassin sets that I've seen personally. I like a lot of his other stuff that he's done before. This one kind of doesn't work for me. I'm never a fan of blacks and blues together in a key set. It just doesn't work for me necessarily. So the fact that you've got a dark grey, almost black next to the blue, it just doesn't work. That being said, the mods and the pink accents do kind of remind me of Laser a little bit. I don't know if anyone else gets that feeling, but it feels like Laser with a different alpha kit to me, just looking at renders. In terms of the base kit itself, it's pretty full featured.
Hold on. This is not the base kit, by the way. He does actually clear this up. He's going to be using the same base kit as GMK Nightshade, which I did actually link in the doc if you wanted to open that as well.
Oh, right. So, okay. Yes, you did. Yes. I missed that.
I'll go ahead and show you guys as well. Obviously, this is a previous work from Blind Assassin, but he is using the exact same kitting, as he says. So we can probably just go off this kitting if you want to judge on how it is. So let's just go.
Yeah, okay. So I won't use that. We'll keep my comments on the colors. In terms of the kitting for this one, then, okay, so there's probably... That looks almost the same kitting. Is there any differences there? I don't know if I see any difference, actually.
I honestly don't know.
I'm trying to flick between the two. I don't think there is actually any difference when I'm flicking between the two. I think it's absolutely the same kitting, and certainly for the base kit, it looked identical in terms of the kitting. I can't see any differences. I'm gonna assume it's the same kitting. I think first and foremost, I think it covers a lot of different layouts, numpad inclusion and all of that, different options for the numpad as well in terms of accent keys, and you can split out that 0-10 strong if that's what you want to do with your numpads. I know you commented on earlier, lots of different alternative keys, accent keys. I think that's great. You can fit out most layouts. You can fit out the semi kind of EU ISO. It does have an extra key in there that's used for UK ISO, so it's kind of two-thirds towards the way of UK ISO, but omits the numero, which is kind of unusual. Usually, if you're going to do basic ISO support, you just do one row 3 key and one row 4 key instead of two, so that's kind of interesting. And then additionally, it's got plenty of different shift size key options as well, if you want to go for that too. I think the base kit's okay. I think it covers pretty much everything. I think very few people are going to be missing something that they need, but HHKB, you know, 60%, 66 key, you know, TKL, everything, 1800 CP layouts, you can fit out pretty much everything with that base kit. It's pretty solid,
yeah. You gotta respect that. There is going to be a space bars kit as well, which will include the Alice B, if that's your thing, and then looks like a 40s kit as well, which looks pretty standard these days. All right, there will apparently be the novelties as well, and potentially other kits, but they are not up there yet. I'm looking around for some renders, but I'm not sure he actually has more renders on this, which seems out of character for Blind Assassin.
Yeah, he does say that it renders. He's got some coming up, but he's waiting for the updated Nightshade ones first. I think there's just a backlog with the render provider that he uses at the moment, so he's just waiting for those. I think it's Metallic Charles, and he's just got quite a few projects on at the moment, so yeah.
Sure. All right. So yeah, just a quick recap here. The set looks pretty decent. The structure looks pretty good for the kits so far. Colors, not my favorite. I definitely prefer, like Iwane says in chat, he prefers Nightshade or Night Runner. And I gotta agree. I feel like those sets just have a little bit more personality. This one feels I'm not gonna say weak, but I don't know. It's not my favorite. I do like the reference image a lot though.
Yeah, the reference image is great. Talisman says, stop, Jay, you're going to trigger a seizure me. I don't control what you see on stream. The only thing I control on stream that you can see is just this box here. If the screen was flicking between things, that's Brian. All on Brian, not me.
Blame Jay. Just blame Jay.
Blame the right person, please.
No. Yes, that's you. Come on, let's get with it. So we'll have to wait and see how this does. Yeah, looking forward to it. I think Night Runner ran already. The Nightshade was after that, but Nightshade hasn't run yet, right? So we haven't actually seen how Nightshade is going to run. But Night Runner seemed to do all right. So I feel like this one is going to be kind of similar in popularity. It should sell well enough.
Yeah, I think this will do just fine. It's one for me, but I do really like that source image. I think it's a great idea to draw inspiration from that. Yeah. But yeah, the set doesn't quite work for me, but I think it will for a lot of people. So
yeah, for the novelties also, he is planning on using some wheels, turbos, and other car parts, which is what he says here. Also, I do believe it's confirmed to be on the key company for the US vendors as well. So
I'm pretty sure that will be the case, yeah.
Yeah, that's what he has listed at least. All right, let's go ahead and move on to our next one here. Which is quite an interesting set, if I do say so myself. This is the interest check for Enjoy PBT Cool Kids, fresh off the presses from Beep. Just after launching GMK Bushido and just after having GMK Dots shipped. So Beep is quite a busy designer. He's been working on a lot of things lately.
This is
a really interesting one. So again, Enjoy PBT Cool Kids here. It uses five different RAL colors. And as you can see here, the font and the orientation on the keys are a little abnormal.
Quirky?
I guess, yeah. Quirky. It's a very playful set, similar to how Dots kind of was. And I feel like...
Playful.
This is going to be one of those things where either you absolutely love it or you absolutely hate it.
Yeah, and I'm kind of in the love it camp. I think it's just quirky enough to be fun. Hi, Salvin. I'm still up. Yes, I'm always up at this time. I'm always streaming at this time. Yeah, it's just playful enough to be fun. I think that having all of the legends kind of off kilter and kind of jumbled up a little bit, it does kind of give it that childish vibe that the whole cool kids kind of thing's going for. It looks like something that would have been in a Gap advert in the 1990s. That's the kind of thing that it reminds me of. But do you know what? I kind of love it for that, and I think that if this does run, which it seems like it's gonna, I probably will pick this up because I think it's just fun and quirky and interesting, and it's unlike things that we've seen before. It just gives it, it's just got a certain playfulness to it that's just fun and unique and nice. And I almost think this is what GMK Froyo might have been able to have been. You know, I think GMK Froyo could have done something a little bit different.
Interesting. Well, Froyo was designed by the Royal, right? That wasn't a beep set.
Yeah. Yeah, it was designed by the Royal, and I did really like Froyo. I think we talked about it at the time. I don't know actually if that made MOQ. I didn't buy it.
I think it just did. I think there were extras bought to get to MOQ, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
But
well, I definitely picked that up in extras. But I do feel like this is kind of in a very similar vein, and there's a lot of different options for this one. I think it works quite well. In terms of the base kit layout, there's a lot of different options in here. You can outfit most boards. Any ANSI user is going to be perfectly happy with it. ISO support is there in this basic format. You can do multiple different bottom rows in terms of 7 U bars and things like that as well. And you can outfit all of the extended layouts, such as 65%, 66 key, HHKB, and pretty much everything in between. There's also a smiley kit, which is kind of novelties, which I think is really, really cute, and you can just dot these around the board, and it reminds me of when I was a kid in the UK. We used to have stickers or stamps that you used to get if you'd done well or good work, and that's kind of fun too. The backpack kit gives us some limited 40s compatibility, and what I do think is really, really fun about this is it's got a have fun key, a yay key, and a nay key. I really like those. I think text novelties, even in a 40% kit, are quite fun and interesting. Definitely quirky and unique, and I really like those. And then you've got the pencils kit, which is space bars. That's a big, big space bars kit. There is a lot of different colors in there, a lot of different space bars. And you know what? It kind of works. And it also perfectly complements the rubbers kit, which is kind of the split and extra small space bars as well. So lots of different coverage you can get from this. Nice to see some 40 support as well. I think it's good. I like it. I like it enough to buy it.
Yeah, I mean, this is kind of like Beep's style, I feel like, in a nutshell. He is kind of a more playful, fun, kind of out-of-the-box sort of designer, and I feel like this kind of fits the theme of him perfectly. You know what else I like? Base kit, you were talking about how good that compatibility is. Only $89. That's not bad.
Yeah, right?
That's pretty reasonable, I gotta admit.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there is that. Hopefully that's coming soon. I believe it's coming June 2020 on KBD Fans, I believe.
Yes, I believe it's a little way out yet, but it is going to be on KBD Fans.
Yep, cool. So we'll have to look forward to that one, because that's certainly going to be a polarizing one, I feel. All right, let's move on to our next interest check here. I know we have a lot of key sets, guys, but we're working through it. We still have quite a few more to go, don't worry. But we're trying to get there. We're gonna try to pick up the pace and lightning round just a little bit here. So this next set here comes from NASP, and this is the interest check for SA Outlander, which is pretty. I'm actually not entirely sure on the source material here. I did read this beforehand,
really?
But yeah, I don't. What is this from?
I think, and I'm pretty.
Oh, so you don't know either. So.
Well, I'm pretty sure I do, but I haven't confirmed this with NASP, but I'm pretty sure it's from Firefly, or it's very heavily inspired by Firefly, the TV show, yeah.
It's only been 15 years since I've watched that.
It's one of my favorite shows of all time is Firefly. I absolutely love it, and this kind of does scream Firefly at me, so.
Yeah, this is quite interesting. So, this is an SA set that this interest check does a lot of things right, I feel like. And first thing I want to point out is obviously the color comparison to other popular sets that other people might think that this looks close to. So obviously, I've been a big fan of this for a long time, and I'm glad he included quite a few sets here. So obviously, you can see Outlander looking a little bit different from those as well. And one thing I really, really enjoy about this, and you know, normally I don't like SA sets, but he actually includes a Chinese character kit here. I believe it's called Chongji or something like that. I'm terrible at pronunciation, of course.
Chongji.
And that looks fantastic. Like, come on.
It looks great, right?
It looks great. Yeah, I absolutely love the way that those characters actually look on SA. I'm not totally sold on the colors, but then again, you know, when am I ever these days? So, which is why I always defer to you on the colors of sets during this show, Jay. Because
The colors kind of work for the source material. If I'm right, I'm assuming I'm right by the source material. I haven't read through the thread other than the actual first post, so I'm assuming that I'm right. But please tell me if I'm incorrect. One of the things that you did miss when you showed the color comparison, if you can just flick back over to that, Brian, is there is a hidden message, and I'm not sure if you noticed it, but the letters that are used are not random.
Please buy, thank you.
It does say please buy, thank you. So I'm not sure if everyone's seen that or not. Or whether people have misnoticed it and things, but I thought that was quite cool. The other really interesting thing is I really like the inclusion of the Mal key. For those who don't know, the guy behind one of the main characters in Firefly,
Captain was called, Malcolm Reynolds.
Malcolm Reynolds, yes. So nice to have a Mal key there, a reference to him. I really do like that inclusion. But yeah, this set works for me. I'm not usually an SA fan, but I think for this particular one, it works really, really, really well. In terms of the kits and everything else, I think it looks pretty good. The regular alphas, you know, fine, not a problem with those. The Chongji, or how you pronounce it, I apologize if we pronounce it
wrong. Gok says we're pronouncing it wrong, so we apologize for that. But
apologize.
It's not a word that I'm used to saying because it's not an English word.
Yeah. So if you've got a better pronunciation for us, Gok, then please tell us.
Yeah, whoever knows how to say it.
Give us a phonetic way of saying it. Yeah.
Yeah. Just go ahead and put the phonetic pronunciation in chat, and hopefully we can get it a little bit more right. Sorry about that, guys. We definitely mean no offense by pronouncing things wrong here.
Absolutely.
We're just awful people that only speak one language. So, regardless, that kit looks amazing.
Yeah, it does. The kit looks great, right? Those characters are really cool. It's something we haven't seen on a board I think those legends really fit the signature plastics and the SA kind of profile because they're so large and it kind of fills up the keycap, and it really works with the brown on the kind of dirty cream kind of color, the almost tan color as well. So I think that works really, really well for me. As well as that, you've got a TKL mod set, which gives you all of your TKL functions and keycaps for ANSI layout. There's also a numpad kit as well, if you want a numpad, ortho mods as well, giving you all those mods, modifiers for ortho boards, extensions, 40s and split bars, the standard SP kits we see from that. There is a UK ISO / US ISO kit as well, so there's compatibility for both in there too, so that keeps everyone happy. And then we get onto the novelties kit as well, which is pretty good. I kind of dig the novelties a lot in this. The jewel, the look keys are really good. Pardon and loot, really, really good as well. I love a text novelty, but I even kind of like some of the character novelties here as well, from everything from the spaceship to the kind of desert and cactus, the sheriff's badge and the cowboy. Really, really, really digging this one. I think it's a really, really cool novelties kit for me.
Yeah, there's actually text novelties littered throughout the set as well, particularly in the ortho mods kit. Which is kind of cool, as well as the 40s and split bars kit. Like they really didn't miss an opportunity to put text novelties in a lot of these, and I really appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So yeah,
and then if you scroll down a little bit further, there is some really, really interesting desk mats as well. So the first one actually references one of the earlier episodes in
Jamestown.
Where they rob the train, right? It references that episode, and I also kind of, I don't see how the second desk mat fits with the theme in terms of the warp and all that kind of thing, but that is a really cool desk mat irrespective. I really like that irrespective. But the heist desk mat is really, really cool, where they heist the train. I think that's episode one, right? From, if I remember, it opens while they're doing the heist on the train. I'm sure that's where it opens. I could be wrong.
No, it opens with like a flashback with Malcolm in like a war or something, if I recall. I don't know.
It's a long time since I've seen it, but
the show is amazing, obviously.
It is a really good show. Yeah, I need to watch it again. I need to convince the missus to watch it again.
Yes you do, and then watch watch the movie and then cry.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's how that goes. At least that's how it goes for me. Regardless, this is looking up pretty nice. Still interest check though, so obviously still looking for feedback as well. But yeah, look forward to this upcoming. Now let's move on to our next interest check here. This is back to the GMK territory. And this is GMK Musician, an interest check from Skeka, I think is how it's supposed to be pronounced. And this is quite an interesting set. As you can possibly tell, this is kind of themed after his kind of favorite instrument, which is the piano. And thus the colors try to reflect that. So this actually does use the same colors as GMK Minimal, if I'm not mistaken, WS1 as well as CR for the black. And we have a little bit of a different structure, though. So we have kind of an all-inclusive bass kit as well as the... what's the best way to describe these kind of different colored rows? What do people call those?
I think it's just alternate color rows, right?
Alternate color rows? Okay.
Yeah. Maybe that's the easiest way to say it.
Yeah, so not a whole lot more to say on this one. Very, very simple black and white set. And, you know, either you're going to love this kind of design like we've been seeing... from the most recent set, GMK Bushido, as well as one other one that we'll be talking about soon, DCS Red Alert rerun here. So this kind of style seems like it's you know, maybe becoming a little bit more trendy than it used to be, where you kind of have...
Well, I think it's coming back, because we used to have quite a lot of sets do it. Yeah, right in the early days. So you mentioned DCS Red Alert. That was one of the really early sets that ran in the community, and then there was a couple of others as well that kind of did alternate color rows for Numro or Fro and things like that. But on this particular one, I think it works quite well. In that bass kit, it looks really, really classy. I don't dislike it at all. And this will work, you know, whether you've got minimal or black on, white on black. You know, two of the most common sets in the community, black on white and white on black. It fits with both of those bass kits if you wanted to use it for something else. And I'm surprised that no one's ever done this before with a set of white on black and minimal. Why has no one ever done this before? I'm really tempted to do this on a couple of my boards and see how it looks in real life. I'm really tempted to do it.
I gotta disagree with you. I don't think it looks very good. I'm a little put off by it. I gotta be honest.
Okay.
So it's okay for us.
We can't all be right.
Yeah, we can't. Yeah. Exactly. Usually you're wrong. So I mean, I'm really good at knowing what it's like to be right. Jokes aside, let's take a look at the actual kitting structure here. So. Disregarding colors here, the base kit actually looks pretty decent. You do have your numpad and all your usual HHKB Sangon 65-75% usuals, as well as I don't know if I'd call them accents at this point, but you know, lots of alternate colors based on whether you want you know, maybe your enter or escape to be a different color as well. But decent spacebar support in the base kit. You have what looks to be basic ISO support.
Yes,
not too bad. And let's take a look right down here to the Maestro kit, which is the novelties kit. Lots of I don't understand most of this because I'm not a musician, but lots of kind of music notes and terminology looks like here. Mm-hmm. Is this supposed to be like Mozart or something?
It seems to be, I think it's supposed to be one of the great composers. Like. I guess it's going to be Mozart or someone else. I haven't looked at it. I wouldn't recognize the pictures, but I'm just going to assume it's some great, great historical composer.
That's fair. Then we have the quartet kit, which is going to be kind of your, I don't know, split space/space/ 40s kit. And then you have, I'm going to mispronounce this, the Capriccio kit. Which I don't entirely understand this, but I gather the theme is to kind of layer the colors, kind of like you see in the piano keys here, where you have the black. I don't know what these are called. Sorry, guys, I'm not a pianist. So
I think
that's kind of what it's supposed to be there for.
If you scroll down, Pingu tried to do a render of what that might look like, I think, where it's actually got on the diagonals, it's got the... it is quite far down in the comments, but I think he tried to lay out what that might look like. So that kind of gives you a feel for what it might do. I think it only goes down to the home row rather than down to the shift row. I think that's kind of the idea that kit gives you.
Yeah, so kind of like I was saying, it's basically the idea of having the black and white piano keys kind of interlaced like they generally are on a piano, so kind of giving you that same effect on your keyboard, which, to be honest, I don't think is quite as successful, but that's just gonna be my opinion. But I think this is gonna be potentially a polarizing set as well. But maybe this trend coming back potentially.
I think it looks pretty classy as it exists in with the two rows there. And I didn't like Bushido for the reason it had the different coloured legends, but I think as the actual different the actual cap colour as it goes, I think it looks really nice. I kind of like this. I'm tempted to try it out and see what it looks like in real life on a board. As I say, just try and maybe put it on a board and see how it comes out. And if it's great, great. If it's not, well, I've not lost anything. But yeah, it's an interesting take on it, for sure. And I do like the novelties. I think the novelties are great.
Yeah. Certainly. So we'll have to wait and see how this one does as we move on to our next interest check for SA Jadeite, I think is what this is going for here, by Hoodrow Thrilson, as well as One Creative Mind. We've of course seen some pretty awesome things from them in the past, and this is, I don't know if I'd call this the same kind of format, but like that striped format, not necessarily the alternate rows, but the alternate columns here. I tend to like this a little bit more, though it's still not entirely for me. But with that said,
you need to refresh the page. You need to refresh the page.
Do I? Why?
You are being told to refresh the page.
Okay, I'm refreshing. I refreshed it. am I gonna live? Am I still alive?
Yeah, you're still alive. Just about.
Yeah. Sorry, I open up all the links right before the show. So if something changes during the show, we usually don't refresh them.
Yeah. I think Hoodrow and OCM have made us refresh it because some things change. That being said, what we've now prepared to talk about may have changed. So if things have changed from what we're going to talk about.
Yeah. all right. We're just going to roll with it, hopefully. Obviously, a relatively jade-themed key set here. He does have some pretty good info. I did read through this earlier, of course. Jadeite is one of the two mineral species that fall under the classification of jade. The other one is called nephrite. And so the kind of overall arcing theme here is sort of based on this source material, this reference image here, which was he had an opportunity to travel to Taiwan. And he saw this, which is, I'm trying to remember the actual name of this, jade cabbage is what this is called. And it's obviously a beautiful piece of jade. And he wanted to kind of translate that over to the key sets. And it looks like this is actually going to be PBT signature plastics, which is kind of interesting as well.
Oh, yeah. That'd be really cool. Yeah, interesting. The other interesting thing as well is Hoodrow does also mention that he did an interest check for cam jade, but this set is most likely to replace that. And I don't think that's a bad decision, to be honest. I kind of like this. The fact that a lot of the keyboard is really clean with that black on white all across the right-hand side, that makes this look a lot more attractive, in my opinion. And I love a good green set. Everyone knows that green is one of my favorite colors. I love a good green set. I think it's really difficult to get greens right in keyboard sets and to get a good green. And I think this kind of pulls it off, certainly in that kind of whole staggered look. I know you're not a fan of that, Brian. I kind of am. I like SA1976, for example, and a few others have done this.
I really dislike 1976. With that said, I actually kind of like it here. I feel like this one's a little bit more tame, a little bit more reasonable, and I like the flow between the lighter and dark colors a little bit more on this. But it's still not really for me, but as far as the execution goes, I feel like this is going to be the most successful one of this style for me.
That makes sense.
I'm going to correct myself here because I did misspeak. I am getting corrected by One Creative Mind in chat. He says it's going to be Max Key ABS color matched to those PBT samples. So color matching to SP's PBT, but it is going to be ABS via Max Keys. So that's pretty interesting as well. But that should give you a quite a bit lower of a price point in theory.
We'll see how that comes out. The interesting thing is, even if this is a Max Key set, it is being kitted out like it would be for Signature Plastics, which is unusual for SA sets. That's kind of pretty much the way things are done these days. So you have got an Alphas kit, which does include all of those different column of your colors on the staggered accents. It also includes a couple of different space bars and also scooped homing keys for F and J as well. In addition to that, you've also got a Modifiers kit, which covers pretty much anyone who use ANSI up to TKL kind of size.
Standard
it's
layout.
Got all of the keys. Yeah, all of the keys that you need there for standard layout. If that doesn't cover what you need, there is an extension kit which offers all kinds of different things, such as stepped caps lock, additional shift keys, control keys, alt keys, all of that kind of stuff as well, just to kind of keep it in the usable theme. As well as that, there's also the numpad, which carries on the kind of staggered accents, but also alternates the direction of them across the numpad, going from light in the top top left, dark in the bottom right, and offers all the usual options there, as well as a UK ISO kit. It is as well as US ISO, so it's US and UK ISO. It doesn't cover any of the EU languages, but it does cover both of those. Forties and Ortho, pretty standard here from Forties and Ortho, from what I can see, mainly geared towards the Ortho, and then reusing some of the keys for the Forties, but that's a pretty good size kit for that. Yeah. And I can't think of many things that wouldn't be covered by that kit. I think most Forties are going to be able to easily use that.
They must be Forties users.
If they designed that.
This kit looks like it was designed by someone that uses a lot of 40s boards.
Knows what they're doing, right? Yeah. It's the type of thing where if I was designing that kit, I'd go to the 40s Discord and go, guys, how does this work? And then cringe and wait for the feedback. But this feels like it's pretty much spot on. Moving on to the last few kits as well, I'll cover the Ergodox kit first. So there is an Ergodox kit, which I think looks really, really good. I don't usually like Ergodox kits, but the way this is kind of staggered to cover both sides of it, that's really, really nice. I'd be tempted to pick that up to put it on the VEA, so I could have that kind of dual column, you know, stagger on the VEA from the Ergodox keys, and then just put the TKL mods on and the ISO kit on as well. I'd be tempted to try that out and see how that would look. I might try and mock that up in KLE and just make sure that I'm right, that it's going to look reasonable and it's not going to mess with the staggers before I try it, but it does look really good. And then finally, the last two kits, there is a space bars kit, which has split space bars and a B key for Alice users, and also a treasures kit, which is all there for the novelties. And I've got to be honest, I really like those novelties as well. I think they work really, really nicely. You've got Buddha, you've got some of the kind of the jade green dragons, and also some keycaps taking inspiration for the enters from that source material as well. So I think it looks really, really good. Definitely a big fan of that.
Yeah, I totally agree. This is this looks like a really successful novelties kit. Not over-designed. Everything's fairly simple there. Fits the theme. Those are my favorite kind of novelties kits. So the kit breakdown here looks really, really good, all things considered. So it's been a little while, I feel like, since we've seen a max key set with a bunch of kits, too. So something we don't usually see a whole lot. But I'm looking forward to this one. I'm really curious to see what kind of pricing we're going to get on this.
Yeah, I think that I'm probably going to pick this up either way. I think it just looks really clean. It's really nice. The renders give it a great look. I think it looks really good on the Neuron. That jumps out at me really strongly. I think it looks great there. I also think it looks really good on the Boardwalk, and I usually hate the way that Boardwalk layouts look. I'm usually not a big fan of that at all, but I really like the look here, and it's that thing that I kind of want to try and replicate on the VEA. So I'm gonna be in KLE tomorrow for at least an hour trying to figure out if it will do that kind of layout on the VEA. So we'll see how it goes. Yeah, definitely a big fan.
Yeah, it's looking pretty good. We'll have to wait and see how this is going. I don't think any of the vendors have been decided yet either, so we'll have to wait and see on that. But let's go ahead and move on to back to the world of anime-themed GMK interest checks. Jay, I know you were worried that we were getting a little too far away from anime-themed GMK interest checks, but boy, howdy, do we have another one for you here. So this is also by Skeka, who was the designer of the musician set we checked out.
Just before we start on this, are we not running out of animes yet?
Oh, sweet, innocent young Jay. I love you. Let's go ahead and actually talk about this, because Jay has never been exposed to the wonderful world of anime, clearly. And so this is GMK Deku, and Deku is the hero name of, let me make sure I get this right, Izuku Midoriya. The main character of My Hero Academia, which is a show that I actually watch and enjoy. And yeah, so this is kind of sourced off his reference image, which is his like superhero suit, his outfit, basically. Deku is the nickname that he goes off of, and the set is themed thusly. So how do you feel? Obviously, you don't know the reference material, but how do you feel about the colors?
I'm not a fan, if I'm honest. I know I said a couple of weeks ago that I really like it when we do sets that have lighter modifiers than alphas, and I'd like to see more of it. Sadly, I don't think this works for me in that kind of theme. I don't dislike the modifiers. I kind of like the modifiers, and I kind of like the accents as well. I just think that there's too much of that color going on across the alphas. It just doesn't quite work for me, I'm afraid, on that side of things. That being said, I do think the kit breakdowns are pretty solid. Like when we talked about the musician set earlier on, I think it's a pretty solid offering in terms of a base kit. It covers most layouts, and I can't think of many things that you'd need to add to that to cover everything, if anything at all, to be honest. I think it's a really solid base kit, but it just doesn't work for me color-wise.
Okay. Well, we're going to disagree a little bit here then, because I actually like the colors quite a bit, and I feel like they did a somewhat decent job of matching the actual reference image, so I definitely appreciate that. I also really appreciate the smash keys for your Windows keys, your GUI keys there.
Yeah.
Text novelties, obviously you guys know I love to see those, and that's obviously a reference to his techniques that he uses in the show. So I love seeing that here. And compatibility actually looks not that bad. Obviously, basic ISO support instead of at least full UK ISO. But other than that, you get a pretty wide array of stuff there. Novelties kit, I'm not as sold on here. It's all right, but I'm not totally sold on it. Plus Ultra, obviously, their school motto. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, these caps at the top here, that's the logo for UA, which is their school. And then he kind of has the Deku mask here, as well as Deku's kind of hair in the top of his face here. Then he has these fists. This is when he activates his power. He kind of has this like glowing light that goes all around his body. I'm not sure what the text is for the bottom left there. Unfamiliar with that. But not my favorite novelties kit, but it looks fine. It's not bad. It's just not that interesting, in my opinion. There's going to be a 40s kit on this one, which looks pretty good. It has quite a bit of split spacebar support, some basic 40s support, as well as your split Alice B there. And then, you know, just because I like to give everyone crap for always using Hiragana Sublegends in their base kit with anime sets, this user has opted for a separate kit that will give you Latin legends without the Hiragana subs. So could be for you, could not be. It is going to be using all Pantone colors as well. And I guess I could show off some of these renders.
Yeah, it just doesn't work for me, and that's fine. Not every set is going to be for me. You know, I think this will do well. It certainly seems to have the source material behind it.
It's a People very seem popular to clearly anime.
Gel with it. Yeah, it seems to be from what I understand. So, you know, I think that, you know, it'll do just fine. I think people are really going to enjoy it.
I like what Cabal Leopard said in chat earlier. He said, "For every anime you watch, two more are made." And I could not agree enough. It's basically not possible to watch anime faster than all of it's produced.
So, right, okay.
You gotta pick and choose your shows.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Anyways, there you go, guys. If you're a fan of My Hero Academia, or you're a fan of Deku the Hero, bam, there you go. This could be a set for you. But moving right along, we have yet another anime-based GMK interest check. This one by... I don't actually mean anything bad by this, guys. I'm not trying to sound like an asshole here. It's just funny to see so many of them in such a short time. Would like to see a JoJo set? Oh, I believe you got one coming. Don't worry. Regardless, we'll get back to that later. This is an interest check for GMK Nichirin by FL Frostbutt here. Nichirin is... So the reference material here is called Kimetsu no Yaiba, also known as Demon Slayer, which is a relatively newer and somewhat popular anime that uses a lot of CG. Boo. But the anime itself is actually quite good, and Nichirin is a reference to, I believe it's the material they make their swords out of, or their weapons out of, or something like that. And this one's also kind of themed around Tanjiro and Nezuko, who are effectively the two main characters. Source material aside, how do you feel about the colors? Also, this is a really interesting lighting for this kit render. You can actually see the lighting gets more exposed as you go up the rows, which is an interesting touch, and I'm not sure how I feel about it as far as a reference for the kit.
I kind of like it because it shows how it might look under different lighting, so I kind of appreciate that kind of thing. Do you know what? I actually don't dislike this set. The dusty pink kind of works for me on the black. I know we talked about a black and red set earlier on and how that didn't, but this dusty pink color kind of works. I don't dislike it. I don't think it's something I would buy, I'll be honest, but I don't dislike it. I think that's where I would put it. The base kit, though, looks pretty full-featured. There's pretty much everything in there, including basic ISO support and, you know, pretty much every possible board combination you want to fit, you can outfit there, as well as a ton of different accent keys. Yeah, I think it looks all right. The number looks really busy to me. I really don't like the tertiary legends on the numero, when you've got like kind of four legends, one each corner.
It's redundant.
That just looks too busy for me. Yeah, way too busy for me.
How do you feel about the Accent F13? When was the last time we saw Accent F13 in a set?
I don't think we've ever seen Accent F13. Apologies, I've got something in my eye.
That's all right. Yeah, I think you might be right. Obviously, chat will correct us, but I don't think I've ever seen another set with an Accent F13. So you get two F13s in this set, as well as an Accent F5 through 8, which is pretty interesting. They're really going hard on the accents in this set.
Yeah, because everyone needs two F13s, right?
Yeah, definitely. So someone in chat saying they don't really see the colors going as well with the source material for Dragon Slayer, or Demon Slayer, rather. I don't actually really remember what the colors are trying to reference here. This is why I really like when people have themed sets like this. If they have the reference image, we've seen that on a few of the sets that we've seen today already. I like seeing that. But unfortunately, this user here, I don't think they provided any reference images. So you don't really have anything to go off of on that. But with that said, I actually like the colorway quite a bit, regardless of whether it's accurate or not. Obviously, I'd rather it be accurate, but I kind of like the dark pink vibes. I'm kind of about
I don't dislike the base colorway. I would much prefer if it was just Latin Legends, but I don't dislike this set. I think it looks pretty attractive in that base kit. Moon's kit as well gives you pretty much most 40 support. It covers a lot of different compatibility there. The Demon's kit, again, I'm not close to the source material, but I kind of like some of the designs. The bottom left, the kind of swirling circle kind of design, I really like that. I don't know what that's for or what it references, but I do really like that as a key. I think it looks great.
Yeah, so the Tanjiro, the main character in the show, kind of has this like special like water themed ability in training where he kind of uses water as along with his sword to, you know, inflict his finishing techniques and such like that. So I think the kind of like the water, the flowing motion is kind of the impact here we're supposed to be taking away.
Sure.
I think the bottom right is his mask. I don't really remember. I'm not really sure what the legends here, the characters are on the top left caps here. Although I do like the way they look. So I like the novelties kit quite a bit here. There's the Hanafuda kit, which is space bars. Pretty standard stuff there. And no more kits after that. So relatively, keeping things relatively simple at least. And I think it looks pretty good. So not much more I can say about that.
I think it looks good. I don't dislike it. I'm not sure it's for me, but I don't dislike it at all. I think the dusty pink is kind of nice, actually.
Yeah. Wait, what board is this? It's 65% with the top right block.
Oh, it says a little bit further up.
Gemini.
Yeah, the Gemini
Mechs. I've never heard of these. Interesting.
Yeah, I think it was, I saw it on Instagram actually a couple of days ago, I think. So I don't know if there's been an interest check for it as yet, but I think it's something that's up and coming.
Enemy says, please do an entire episode based on explaining J colorways of anime shows you barely remember. You guys like that? My memory is trash, dude. My memory is like absolute garbage. So I usually forget most. This is why I watch like any anime that I actually like remotely, I watch at least twice, if not more. Otherwise, like I'll forget basically everything about it. But I like the idea of trying to convert Jay into a weeb because his personality completely does not fit it. So I think that'd be pretty fun. But regardless, this is the interest check for GMK to Chirin, and let's go ahead and move on to something that's actually not interest check, something that's out of interest check. So we forgot to cover this last week, but this is the group buy for GMK Nautilus 2 by Zombumon over on DixieMech.com for your US proxy. Rest of your proxies listed there. And again, yeah, we didn't talk about this last week, even though we should have. But that is, of course, my fault. But let's take a look at the follow-up here. I think the colors are all the same from the first run, if I recall, but I think the kitting is quite a bit different this time around. So, obviously, the set, I believe it ran in 2017, if I remember correctly, the original run of GMK Nautilus. And I think it...
Yeah, it sounds about
obviously,
right.
Chad will correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was the first GMK set at the time to achieve a $100 base kit at 1,000 MOQ. So that was a pretty big deal back at that time. And it's obviously it's evolved a little bit since then. It looks like we're going to have a $115 base kit this time, but let's take a look at the structure. It looks like a pretty standard Zombiemon base kit. He does like to forego the ISO in the base kit entirely, and we see that again here, but he does keep in things like the numpad, all your basic HHKB Sangon support, as well as the accents in 70 bottom row. So you still get a pretty decent compatibility in that, you know, barring ISO users.
Mm-hmm.
And there's going to be a an extension kit called the Explorer, which is kind of like I don't it would obviously be wrong to call this a 40s kit because it's not, but it's kind of like an alternative compatibility kit based on some of the less popular things in the community, I guess, like F13 and, you know, all that kind of sort of stuff. And then there is a 40s kit, obviously, with pretty good compatibility. It's a pretty good 40s kit, actually. And then there is an international kit, which not only gives you your basic US and UK ISO, but gives you a lot of your other ISO as well. However,
that's pretty much everything.
That's a pretty expensive kit, though. If I recall, it's like $72. So
yes,
if you are an ISO user, you're spending at least $200 on this set.
Yes, I was just working it out a second ago. So if I wanted to buy both of these, and I was going to buy them from from Oblotsky Store, which is the EU proxy, I'd be looking somewhere in the region of €191, which is just shy of $210 at the current exchange rate. Whereas I did get UK ISO in the original base kit, I think with drop, I think it was $109 at that time. Plus VAT and taxes and the $25 or whatever. So it was probably around $130 last time. It'd now be $208 for me to cover my layout. Admittedly, I would have some additional international keys that I might not use otherwise, but it does make it very, very much more expensive.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it is a pretty pretty nice international kit, all things considered. Depleted Vespine is saying it's missing R3 pipe. Is it really?
Yeah,
you're right.
It doesn't have that. That's for US ISO.
That's for US ISO.
So I think what the view here is that very much the base kit is very much US ANSI based, and then the international kit is very much EU international kit based, with the assumption that no one wants ISO in the US. I think that's...
And I mean, in his defense, a lot of his sets that he structures like this have been selling fairly well, so maybe this is just the structure that works for him. So there's that. There's also a Mac kit. If you're a Mac user, obviously. And then there's a pretty small novelties kit, but a pretty good one. Gets right to the point. Obviously, you have this kind of compass going on here. You have some Jules Verne text novelties, and you have the classic kind of squid marine thing going on here. I believe the ship is actually called the Nautilus, or the Nautilus 2, if I recall. But yeah, that's obviously a pretty iconic novelties there. And then you have kind of an accent spacebar kit there. And then he has a nice pricing graph. Love to see that. And then, you know, just like most other sets these days, he has some kind of premium novelty option. This one with Rama, with that Squid Marine and some source material there. So, and some cable collabs, of course. We generally, these days, we don't really go over a lot of this stuff anymore just because every single set has it. And to go over every single item for every single set would make this show about 17,000 hours. So... which is why we kind of gloss over those at this point. But regardless, this set is open right now, and I believe it's open until May 5th. So you have quite a while to get in on this.
Plenty of time to enjoy.
Yeah, plenty of time, guys. And yeah, if you missed out on the first run, here's a good time to pick it up now. Moving right along, like we were talking about earlier, now we have the group I opened for DCS Red Alert Round 3. And this is a pretty interesting one for a couple reasons. One, obviously, it's a rerun of DCS Red Alert, which is classic, legendary, and iconic in our community for lots of reasons. But also, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's either the first or one of the first sets that are actually running through Dixie Mech's new fulfillment service.
Yeah, I believe it's the first that's actually got... I have no idea how many people are talking to Dixie about using the service, but I believe it is the first one to actually go live. And to be honest, it's not a bad price for a base kit that's pretty accessible, to be honest. So it is based on a very low MOQ, just 75 units to be sold to make sure that this gets made. $119.99, so $120 plus shipping. But the base kit covers a lot of options. The only thing it really forgoes is a numpad. If you don't need a numpad, then you're pretty much okay with this base base kit, which is kind of nice to go with, I think. I think it's not a bad way of doing it. Now, Dixie's Fulfillment Service does mean that you have to only use one kit. It means that you can't use multiple kits, and I think that's just to make it easier from a fulfillment perspective. So that's why Numpad has been dropped here, to keep the price low because the MOQ is quite high, but also to make sure that people can get the right keys for the majority of layouts. And this seems to be covering what is the most popular in terms of that. So everything from ANSI 6% up to TKL, there is ISO support, including accent keys as well for basic ISO, as well as alternate offerings for the bottom row. So you can have a 7U bottom row, steps, caps lock, a control key for caps lock as well, and then some 65% modifiers and some further accents too. You can also lay out with a HHKB setup if you really want to as well. And additionally, what we also have here is the whole row one accent num row. So this was really, really popular to use in the original run of DCS Red Alert, and people used to put that whole num row in red on most boards.
Oh, yeah.
It was very rare. You used to see people do it with the whole with just the white keys and the red legends.
I don't think I've ever seen
almost,
it.
Almost I've got the original set, and I don't even know if it has the white keys with the red legends for the num row in there. I think I've only got the red num row. But it is really good to see this coming back. I'm definitely going to be jumping on this because it is really good to see back into the fold. It's one of my favorite sets of all time. And DCS, underrated key set, underrated profile. We don't see enough DCS. It's been a long time since we've had a DCS set actually run, and I don't think we see enough of them. I think we should see more.
I agree. And one thing that's actually happening here that's kind of cool is previously in runs of keycaps from Signature Plastics, for example, when you get those higher MOQs, you get price breaks. Here they're doing something a little bit different. So obviously, like we were talking about, the minimum MOQ here is $75 unit MOQ. This is the base kit that you get. It's $120. However, if they hit a 150 MOQ, they're actually going to be adding additional keys to this kit. So instead of getting a price break, you're going to get more compatibility and more options overall. So if they do hit that 150 MOQ or higher, they are going to be considering including things like red space bars, 6U space bar, white on red arrow keys, extra B for your Alice layouts, re-legendable keys for each row, split space bars, and potentially, get this, a 10U space bar. So, for the memes, of course, like he says. But kind of interesting there.
Yeah. I really, really hope this gets a 10U space bar, because I will make that work on a board if that happens.
I think a lot of people will make that work. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's pretty interesting. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how this is going to go, being run through Dixie Mech's new fulfillment service. It seems like a pretty straightforward way to go. I mean, there's one kit, one price, and the MOQ is quite small. It feels like this is going to do pretty well. That 150 MOQ is really not even close to being out of the question either, honestly. I feel like this set won't struggle at all to sell 150 or more.
I think it's got a good chance of getting there. I think the other thing that's interesting as well is because it's Dixie Mech's fulfillment service, there is no proxies. That means it just runs through Dixie. No one else is helping out with proxying and stuff, which does mean that if anyone wants to order, they have to order from the US. Now, for international users, that can be quite painful. Shipping can be quite expensive. There's also all sorts of different fees that you have to pay on imports and costs and things like that as well. Sol, the guy behind this, Solshalite, is also outside of the US, and he has provided some information on different basically freight forwarding companies. If you've ever used Superbuy when you're buying from Chinese sites, it's very much similar, but apart from it, buying from the US. So there's a couple of different options that you can use, both referral links and non-referral links if you don't want to use those. So it's definitely worthwhile considering those if you are outside of the US or you don't have anyone in the US that can proxy for you. Brian, you might end up getting my set and have to send it on to me.
Yeah, send me one, Jay. Let's see how that goes.
Like my 60 years to get back, yeah.
Thanks. Yeah, I'll proxy any of these. So just send me as many as you want, Jay. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. So yeah, that's open right now, guys. And I think it runs till the end of the month. Yeah, it runs till April 30th. So the end of the month. You still have a little ways to get in on this. But I highly suggest you do, because like Jay was saying, DCS really is an underrated keycap profile. I'm really interested to see how this Dixie Mech fulfillment service works, as well as you just got to support Solshalite, because he's such a good guy. He does a lot of great in the community. A lot of good, a lot of great, honestly. And this is no exception.
I do not understand how this group by thread has only got two comments on it after the opening post. I genuinely don't understand that, because this is such a good set and it was so popular back in the day. It was like the set that everyone had to get hold of. I think too many people on the GMK hype train, and that DCS is getting a bad rep, and it shouldn't, because it's a great profile. And yes, it's a little bit thinner, but it's really nice to use. It sounds good, even if it is thinner, and you know it gets a bad rep. Perhaps this isn't being marketed in quite the right way, but I absolutely think that this is a great set, and I'm really surprised that in 4 days there's only been two comments.
It's been 6 days now. This was posted on the 3rd. So
I was looking at the first comment.
Yeah. I'm going to assume that the reason there aren't many comments is because nobody has anything bad to say about it, and they're just buying it. They're just like, hey, yes. Maybe. And they buy it, and they don't comment. That's what I'm hoping is happening. Rip the lag. Yeah, I don't know if you noticed, Jay, but you were cutting out quite a bit, both visually and audibly. But we still heard mostly everything. It's just Discord server issues at this point.
We'll blame Discord for that. Apologies, guys. I do apologize. It's not easy when we're halfway around the world from each other.
It certainly isn't. So I know he's frozen right now. There's very little I can do about that, unfortunately. Just Discord. Lots of people on Discord right now, and lots of people using resources because everyone's quarantined. So. Unfortunately, that means bandwidth is a little bit more limited for some people in some ways, in some scenarios, and I feel like Discord video calling is currently one of them for us. So I apologize for that. Hopefully we'll have that fixed by next week. But we do what we can with what we have. Anyways, back to the news here, guys. This is currently open now, runs until the 30th. And any more to say on that, Jay?
No, not at all. Other than I think we should really support it, and I will be buying it. So
yeah, I'm gonna try to buy one of these as well. All right, let's move on to what is the last topic on our news doc? Sort of. This is another one that I think we forgot to cover last week as well. We covered the interest check a few weeks ago, and then I thought we covered the group buy, but apparently we didn't. But I'm gonna kind of duo link these since they are kind of sister sets. But basically, what we have here is a Drop plus Mito designed GMK Belafonte custom keycap set here. This is based off the Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou. And this is designed by Mito, of course. And we did check this out a few weeks ago, so nothing new there. And it's running alongside another set designed by Mito called GMK Hennessy, which also, I believe, fits the same theme. It's just kind of a different inspiration from it. But it's a... effectively a black on white set also, depending on how you look at it.
So in the film, if you guys haven't seen it, there are kind of like two factions. There's the faction that the film's based around, Steve Zissou, and the Belafonte is the name of his ship. There is also, and they're explorers. That's kind of like the whole thing. They're very much aquatic explorers. But there is also other people who are explorers in the kind of universe as well. And one of those is a character called Hennessy, who has his own company, and they are very austere in how they dress. It's very stormtrooper white and black accents, and the ship's painted, white and black, and it's all kind of modern and high tech and much more robust and popular than the Steve Zissou cast as well. So that's where the two inspirations come from. It's two flip sides of the same film. You could imagine almost one, if you want to put a Star Wars spin on it, you can imagine one being almost like kind of Stormtrooper inspired and one being Jedi inspired. It's kind of that kind of thing, taking the two factions from a movie and making a set about each.
Sure. All right, so just on that note, there is a little bit of a price difference on these as well. So Hennessy, which is, again, a black-on-white featured set, is actually only going to be $100, which is not too bad considering the compatibility here. It's not terribly unlike GMK Minimal in some ways. You have your full-text mods here, although these all use lowercase legends, so that's a little bit different.
Yeah.
And you get some split spacebar support in the base kit, so a pretty decent base kit for $100, I would say. Similar kind of over on the Belafonte side, it's $120, so $20 more, but you do get quite a few more keys here, including a numpad as well as basic ISO support and some accents. And of course, all the other things that you would expect to see. This is actually a pretty good base kit. It has the split space bars, quite a few of them, accents. You have all your usual suspects, including the numpad and the basic ISOs for $120. That's really not that bad, all things considered.
Yeah, I do have a problem with the basic ISO support here. Mito has chosen to use for the row 3 key, instead of using any of the accepted options such as pipe or hash or tilde or anything like that, he's chosen to put an any key there, an any key, which kind of galls me a little bit. I'm not a massive fan of that.
Yeah, two of them, in fact. He has one in the row 3 and one in the row 4, so that's going to be your kind of basic ISO support here, which is a really odd way to go about it, but
there is pipe for row 4. It's right at the very bottom.
I see it now. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So there is pipe for row 4, but yeah, you have to use an any key for row 3, which doesn't really fit, and it will look really weird and jarring, in my opinion.
Yeah, that's certainly an interesting way to go about it, but I mean, with that said, the price is pretty decent. You know, compatibility is decent as well. All going to be based on who you are, obviously. There's some other kits
sure,
as well.
Yeah.
There's a Spacebars kit. There's the Novelties kit, which they're calling the Decorations kit, at least for the Belafonte set. So, yeah. Both of those currently open now, guys. Are you going to pick up either of these?
I'm a really big fan of the film. I'm probably not going to pick either of the kits up, the base kits. I do really like the Novelties for Belafonte, though, because I'm a big fan of the movie. They kind of are quite nice, but it wouldn't really fit with anything else. So I haven't decided, but it's unlikely I'll pick it up.
All right. Well, there you go. So now we're going to roll into a bit of a sponsor spot, guys. Then we're going to do our Q&A like we always do right after. We're going to try to make this a little bit quicker of a one since we are quite a bit over our time, or at least projected to go quite a bit over it. So if you guys have questions, start asking them now. Use the @TopClack tag and we can see them a lot easier. It helps us out way more than you might think. So please, please, please use that. And with that said, let's talk about some of the amazing people that help TopClack do the things that we do. Starting out, first and foremost, with the wonderful Novelties. Tons and tons of things going on right now, as usual. They have the GMK White on Black Extensions kit, which is pretty awesome. So if you need a little extra compatibility there, that's going to be absolutely for you. The current samurai-themed beep-designed set going on here right now, GMK Bushido. It is quite an interesting one as well, if you're into that. $125 gets you a pretty nicely kitted out base kit there. Of course, they do still have the GMK RGB add-on kit going on here too, which is pretty awesome. Nice little kind of throwback to when people used these a lot many years ago. $60, honestly not that bad for as many keys that it comes with. You can probably add numerous boards with different colors there if that's your thing. They have lots of desk mats going on right now, as you might expect, including the Godspeed V2 desk mats going on right there in stock, as well as the Hawk desk pads, which is, I think, a bit of a newer one. And, of course, he's a pretty full-featured vendor when it comes to keyboards. He sells a lot of things, including switches and springs and lubes and desk mats and sets. And look at this plushie. Look at this Gatoron. I mean, who wouldn't want to own one of those? Let's be honest. It's just fantastic. So pretty much something for everyone over at Novelties. And if you're buying things in stock, make sure you use the promo code ClickClack. One word, ClickClack, and it'll get you a little 5% off your total order there. Yeah, the olive toy is amazing. Like, I legitimately always have both of these, like, on my desk facing me. Always.
See, Gatoron's behind me. He's always on the shelf up there guarding things, but the olive is always on the desk. Yeah, it's always just around. Awesome. I did get caught. Funny story. I did get caught playing with this on a work conference call, and I was just stood there going like this, and taking the pimento out and putting it back in, and I forgot I was on camera for work Discord call. That was an interesting conversation, to say the least.
Fantastic. All right, who else we got, Jay?
Okay, so jumping over to our second sponsor of today, it is Kono.store. I know we talked about them at length earlier on with the whole Sharko debacle, and we hope that that gets fixed first and foremost in the near future. That being said, if you aren't looking for GMK Sharko Round 2, they do have pre-order items on all of the sets that you might have missed recently. So if you missed GMK Hero and you want to pick that up, or GMK Copper, or any of the other sets they've run recently, Cat Oasis is up there as well, you can go and rejoin those at a pre-order price. It's effectively like joining the the group buy just a little bit later, but you will get it at the same time as group buy arrives and ships. That being said, they also have a whole range of Kale Pro and Speed Switches back in stock as well. So if you are looking for those Kale Switches, you can pick them up from Kona direct, and they are shipping immediately. Now, one thing to bear in mind with Kona at the minute is they are moving warehouses. So anything that you order, I think up to a certain date, is going to get shipped. They do have notifications on the site for this, so you can go take a look, but they are moving warehouses at the moment as well. If keyboards are more your thing and you're looking for something to get someone into the hobby, or you want to try and influence someone, maybe your work colleagues working from home needs a keyboard rather than using a laptop one, you might want to recommend that they pick up a Hex Gears series, either the Gemini, the X1, or the Ventura. Really, really good, super low profile, wireless mechanical keyboards that should get anyone going and raring to go in the hobby. So definitely check those out if you're in the market for that.
Absolutely. Next up, we have KBD Fans, who has quite a few new things going on, which is kind of interesting. So they have a few new arrivals in, including the TF V2, which I think is what's supposed to effectively be the new updated Tofu 60% design. And yeah. And boy, does it look pretty awesome. We're going to talk about that more on another episode, of course, because we have more details coming. But it honestly looks pretty good for the price. And again, we'll talk more about that later, but I'm kind of excited about that one. Also, they have a new key set in with collaboration with GOK. This is Enjoy PBT X GOK, a black on white keycap set. And this is effectively kind of like the Kuroshiro that GOK, I think it was GOK that did that somewhat recently on KBD Fans. This is kind mm-hmm. of more of a simple Latin legend kind of design. So if you're a fan of Enjoy PBT and you want a black on white set, this is going to be a pretty good one. $89 base kit gets you a quite a decent amount of compatibility, honestly, all things considered. And of course, they still have lots of other things in stock. They have a bit of a B-stock market thing going on right now. They actually have a few things in their B-stock market. I was going through this earlier. They have a few cases in stock. I'm not going to list all of them. But obviously, if you're looking for some incredibly inexpensive potential B-stock options, I highly, highly suggest you, you check this out. They have a little list of what each number corresponds to. You can pick yourself up a Tofu or, you know, a 5-degree or some other things for basically pennies, which is always kind of cool. And, you know, of course, they still have numerous things, as they usually do. So whether you want switches or, you know, all sorts of PBT or ABS keycaps, they got something for you. They still have some of the Enjoy PBT ABS stuff, which I've been checking out more recently as well. You know, they have it all, basically. They have so much crap. So much stuff. So much. So, yeah make sure to check that out, especially if you're newer to the community, because they have a lot of really inexpensive, value-oriented options, which I always appreciate quite a bit. So, if you're trying to ball out on a budget in the keyboard hobby, you should definitely give KBD Fans a look.
Yeah, absolutely. Moving over to the Key.company, our next sponsor of today. They have a ton of different stuff that's either there or coming at the moment. They do have a group buy for Ink Apparel, so a match made Ink Heaven is the tagline they're using for this, but basically lots of keyboard related goodies, from t-shirts to hoodies and all sorts of different stuff in there. So definitely go and check those out if you're into some pretty cool designs. Even if I do say so myself, there's some pretty cool stuff in there. If key sets are more your thing, then Infinity Grayan or Gran, or however you want to pronounce it, the grey green set is now in group buy as well, so definitely go and take a look at that. They've also got GMK Black Lotus launching tomorrow as well, so if that's your thing, do take a look at it. It's been in interest check since 2016, so it's been going for a long time now, but it's finally in group buy, and we'll talk about more about that next week, or Brian will. There's also Candy Bar Extras, and round two is coming as well, so if you're interested in picking up a candy bar or you missed out on the group buy, then do take a look at that. In keeping with the keeping things cheap, though, you might want to take a look at the Creative Cherry Profile ABS blanks as well. For just $24, you can get a pretty much fully decked out blanks kit, which should cover pretty much any keyboard you could need it to, as long as you don't need split spacebar support. I think that's the only thing it really struggles with. But even then, there's a lot of keys, a lot of different options, a lot of different colorways. You can definitely go check those out, and it's a really, really good way to try Cherry Profile if you haven't done. And finally, just a shout out that they are launching the Keyboard University as well. We did talk about this a little bit last week, definitely time to check that out if you're interested. Basically, it's kind of a resource repository for all things mechanical keyboards that TKC are sponsoring, and it might offer you some good insights or some thoughts on what you want to look at.
Yeah, I've actually been checking it out a little bit lately, and it's kind of cool. It's nice to have these kind of tools in the community. But regardless, last but not least, we do still have the wonderful Mechanisk, our newest sponsor, who has a few things going on right now that are pretty interesting. The Clippa T is still available for pre-order too. Whether you want a polycarbonate version or you want an aluminum version, he's got you covered. $199 gets you a fully kitted out Clippa with your choice of plate, your choice of layout on that plate, as well as a very nice WT60D PCB, which he also does stock individually if you like it. It's probably one of my favorite, if not definitely my favorite, 60% PCBs on the market currently. It has all the goodness you want. It has VIA support, USB-C, flex slot cuts, designed by Wilba. It looks absolutely immaculate. And I can't speak highly enough for it. So very, very cool stuff there. And also, he doesn't have them listed yet, but we do have some insider information coming soon. Actually, he does have a little bit of a placeholder for it now. But he does have stabilizers coming. I believe they are Duroc stabilizers. And from what I hear, they are going to be using the ultramarine colorway. So we're actually need kind of a Mechanisk exclusive Duroc stabilizer in that signature colorway that has been selling quite well, honestly. And that's pretty awesome. So I'm looking forward to that. He also does have the Type X coming soon. Which is pretty awesome, another alternative to the Clippa, and I actually do have one right down here, and I'm probably going to be doing a build stream with that tomorrow. So if you want to see me come play around with that, maybe not use a plate, maybe I'll swap and use a plate, see what kind of flex we can get with that particular PCB in the Type X. So that's going to be pretty awesome, so make sure to come check that out tomorrow night. I'll probably do that after we do the Keyboard Jeopardy, so it'll probably be somewhere around 7:30 Pacific time when I do that stream. Anyways, let's get to the Q&A here. And Jay, I hate to do this to you, but I really have to pee because I drink so much water and the show is long. So,
man,
you got to start the Q&A alone. Just the first question. I'll be right back. Don't hate me,
Jay. Yeah, whatever. We'll see if he's back or not.
Sorry, guys.
I don't know.
This when you got to go, you got to go.
Professional streamer here.
Hey, I never said professional. I never said professional. BRB.
Yeah. Well, while Brian does that, let's take a look and see if I can work out what the first question is. I'm just going to scroll back through the chat and see where it answers. So, Hug Fangin, he says, "Took like got a question for Jay via Discord." Okay, so I do have a load of pings on Discord. I don't know your Discord name. I have about, hold on, I've got about 36 different pings at the minute, it looks like. So if you can let me know your username on there, I can definitely come back to that and cover it for you. Second question, Ubmit or UBMit says, "Have you guys covered GMK Black Lotus?" So GMK Black Lotus goes live on Friday. It's technically Thursday now in the US where we're doing the show. So it will be covered on next week's show. We did kind of talk before the show as whether we're going to cover it this week or not. It's not going to be covered this week. It is going to be covered on next week's show because it's not live right now, and we try and just keep it with what's live at the moment. There's quite a few other key sets, GMK Bleached and a few other bits and pieces that are launching it this weekend. We definitely try not to include them twice. I think we've already talked about Black Lotus twice on the show, once years and years ago, and then we talked about it a couple of months ago as well. Not in particular relation to the IIC, but I think it did get mentioned in one of the conversations. So we'll be covering Black Lotus next week. Welcome back, Brian. Glad to have you back. Yeah, right. Yeah, I hope you washed your hands. Yeah. You didn't seem to be. I don't want to see. Right, okay, we're now on to the Heat Loss's question. He says, "Can we play for Ray? His migraine is still going." Ray, if you're watching, if you're listening, I hope your migraine has gone or it's getting better. Migraines are not good, and I feel really sorry for anyone that's suffering right now.
Yeah, that's a bummer that he's still going on. Yeah, so for those of you who don't know, I often hang out with Ray most nights. We watch anime or play games or something. And like a lot of people, he does get really awful migraines, and it's very unfortunate because I sympathize with that because I used to get migraines a lot too. Thankfully, I don't get them as much anymore. But migraines are rough, man. That's like your day's already over when once you get a migraine. Yeah. Like you don't do anything else. Like you cancel everything. Like you pop a bunch of ibuprofen or something, and you try to sleep it off basically. And it's kind of unfortunate. Anyways, where are we at in the Q&A here?
So we're just up to Bearded Nutting. He donates 100 bits. And he says, "Gotta go now, guys. It's 5:30 a.m. and have several things to do tomorrow. Great show as always. See you next time." Well, thank you very much for watching, Bearded Nutting. We will catch you next week. Yeah. Let's see what's up next.
Sean Francis Ryan Esquire. is asking, do you think GMK Black it is do you think GMK Black Lotus will pair well with the Chimera 65 dark gray lilac? Interesting. The lilac so, was one of the better colors of Chimera.
It is. My worry would be that the purple might clash, but I certainly think that the alphas and the standard modifiers will work well, but if you use the accents, it might clash a little bit. Other than that, I think it'll look all right.
Yeah. Man, Black I think Lotus Black Lotus is gonna be, good. I think that'll go with a surprising amount of boards. I think it's going to sell really well, too. Man, like, have we had another key set in the community that took 4 years between interest check to group buy?
No, we've had one that took 5 years between group buy and shipping, but not
did we?
4 years.
Which one?
I still don't have my F8 key for Hyperfuse.
Sorry. Hyperfuse aside, because that's the more unique single key situation. But full set.
Oh, there's still sets that haven't been shipped, I think. There's still full sets that haven't been shipped.
Oh, are there?
I might be wrong on that, but yeah, I think there's still people.
Well, I think we can all agree that is a little unique because that's an issue. Black Lotus wasn't necessarily an issue. It just took them that long to get to group buy for one reason or another. Regardless, never mind. Whatever. next question from Depleted Vespeen is asking, for the QA section, do you have a keyboard in your collection, modern or vintage, pre-built or custom, that is not good or fit for your use that you nevertheless keep around for emotional or other subjective reasons? I actually have my Tokyo 60. I like the board, don't get me wrong, but it's kind of like it's my silent board. I have like a hot swap PCB with lubed Helios in there, so it's like my kind of like compact travel board that's like mainly there for silence. I don't like silent switches like at all, but I have that board and I basically never even use it, but I have that board built up for that purpose, should I ever need silence, basically.
Yeah, I've got a few. I wouldn't want to upset people by saying which particular boards they are, but there's quite a lot that I keep around, whether I use the board or not, because I've got emotional kind of ties, or they came from a person that I care about, even if I don't like the board itself. So I wouldn't want to call out any specific examples, but yeah, absolutely. Of course, there's things like that. Everyone has things like that in their life that they have no particular use for. They don't particularly like to use it, but they keep it around because it's sentimental. You know, there's a lot of things like that in life.
Yeah. Absolutely. All right, looks like Enemy has our next question here. Is asking, earlier you talked about calling out Kono for Shoko round 2. What do you say about the deceptive advertising TKC is doing with the Mint Candy Bar Premium keyboard pictures for reference? I can't really look at Discord right now, but what's the scenario? Have you heard about this yet, Jay?
No, I was trying to look in the Discord whilst you were away, but then answering questions as well, so I'm not quite sure what was going on there. I can't see anything. I've looked back to like an hour ago in the chat. I can't see anything there.
I do see Enemy that's posting I assume that's a candy bar.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, I've gone a bit further up, yeah.
Sorry, I'm learning about this in real time, so I don't really know what this is about.
So is that green picture, is that what the mint should have been? Or is okay, so that's how the mints come out. Okay, so that doesn't look like the mint color, I think, is what the complaint is here. So the mint color has come out more of a, I guess you'd call it forest green.
Okay,
I think that's what they're trying to say. Enemy's friend, if we're wrong on this, try and please correct us, because we are seeing it live here. So I'm trying to read through and have a look. Look like it's quite different.
I think the bottom line is always going to be, if you advertise the color and you don't deliver that color, some people are going to be upset. And whether it's TKC or anyone else, I think that's kind of just the bottom line here. And it's unfortunate that people are receiving sets that are not colored the way they should have been colored. So
yeah, that's
obviously not a good thing.
No, there's always going to be slight differences between anodization. Even if you have do 10 boards of the same color, there are always going to be slight differences. But there should never be a big difference in terms of, it shouldn't be a different color. You shouldn't be getting a forest green if you've bought a mint green. That does seem like it's kind of out of you know, that should have been caught within quality control, I would suspect. So yeah, I'm very surprised that. Is this just a one-off, or is for the people reported this as well? You know, one-offs can always happen. So
yeah,
don't know.
It'd be great to know if this was like an individual issue, or if it's like an actual widespread thing where all the colors are wrong or something.
Yeah.
We'll have to look more into that, because, like I said, that's totally new to us. I haven't seen this at all. It happened during the show, and I don't look at Discord during the show. So, not a whole lot I can say on that right now. But obviously, whether TKC is a sponsor or not, we always want vendors to deliver the advertised product. And there's not really a whole lot more to say about that, I feel like.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't think anyone's going to be like, yes, TKC delivered the wrong colors. Nice. Like, nobody's going to say that, but I think we're all kind of in agreement that's like, oh, crap, like, it should have been the right color.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. All right. Sorry, I'm just trying to catch up on questions here. Rabbit Sensei asking, what's your favorite weeb set you own? Favorite weeb set you own?
I don't think I own any weeb sets.
I don't know if... I mean... It seems like I've noticed a lot of people seem to consider Mizu a weeb set, so I do own Mizu.
Oh, really?
Mizu, but
I own that as well.
I don't think it's a... I mean, Mizu is a Japanese word, but the theme that it's based off of, Avatar, obviously, is an American cartoon. So, is it a weeb set because it has a Japanese name? What defines a weeb set, I think, is the question we need to ask ourselves before we find out what we own. But I think Mizu would be the only thing that anyone would consider a weeb set that I currently own, I think.
Yeah, I don't know what the official definition of a weeb is. I think my head, it associates anime with that kind of thing, and I don't really know where the fuzziness in between that lies.
Yeah.
I do have Mizu, so if that counts, that's the only one I could say. I don't know if, Vaporwave kind of aesthetic sets such as Laser or GMK Vaporwave or anything like that else would count, but I do own a couple of those as well, but I wouldn't say I had anything particularly weeb-ish. Personally,
yeah. I think we talked about this somewhat recently on an episode just a few weeks ago, and I'm pretty sure people were getting upset at me that I thought Mizu wasn't a weeb set, and that's when like I went live on the show and I was like, wait a minute, this is made by two Western white guys, like this is not you know, Japanese culture or material. This is very much an American made cartoon. But I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what people consider weeb sets. I don't think there's like an overarching consensus on what is and what is not a weeb set. I always kind of assumed weeb sets were based on anime and included hiragana sublegends. That's what I always thought a weeb set was, but
I mean, that was generally the kind of definition in my head, but I wouldn't want to put a box on stuff like that sometimes.
Yeah, I'm not going to claim
for risk of upsetting some people. So,
yeah. Well, we're going to upset people regardless, no matter what happens. That's just the way this kind of thing works. But yeah, I don't think it'd be good for us to put a box on it and be like, this is the end all be all, because people obviously have different opinions on what it is. And some people think Mizu's a weeb set. I disagree, but I'm not going to fight people on it. So
if it counts, I have it. Yeah.
Viper asking, how did Mech Madness 2020 go for you guys? Any interesting opinions on the results? So actually, we were going to talk about that on the show today, but I completely forgot with how packed our news doc was.
We should add it to next week's doc and just briefly talk about it next week, I think, because it might be a little bit quiet then. So watch next week, Viper, and we'll definitely cover that next week.
Yeah. All right. Royal asking, Liminal, which I recall is a product that he recently group buyed, but it was open for like a couple days and it wasn't during a time frame where we could cover it before it was closed, if I recall.
We don't cover everything on the show that goes into group buy. We just wouldn't have the time if we were going to do that. So there is a lot of stuff that doesn't make it onto our news docs. Yeah. I'm really sorry about that. It's not a slight against anyone or an upset thing against anyone. It's just there's so much stuff in the community these days. It's almost impossible for us to cover it unless we did a 6-hour show. And you guys don't want to watch us for 6 hours, let's be honest.
Yeah.
I'd have to take a lot of break then.
Yeah. I mean, I drink so much water, man. Anyone that gives me crap for having to pee every like 3 hours needs to drink as much water as I do, and you'll understand the pain. Also, yes, I was muted, by the way. That's why people were complaining earlier. I was only muted for a couple seconds, and I said something, but it wasn't important. Don't worry about it. So anyways, back on this. Herms is asking, just arrived, so hopefully haven't covered this. What color 7V are you fellas getting? I cannot afford a 7V, unfortunately. And I don't remember what the color options are. But what are you getting, Jay?
I don't know if I'm going to get the 7V. For me, it's a choice between the 7V and the Dawn. I think I'm probably erring on the side of getting a Dawn instead. I'm probably not going to pick up a 7V.
Yeah, I'll probably...
That doesn't mean you guys shouldn't. It's a very good looking board. It's very attractive.
It looks very good, and I think it's going to sell quite well. A lot of people have been really hyped about it, and I certainly don't blame them, but I'm pretty picky and choosy with my 75%, and I mean, there's not really a whole lot that I honestly want. I kind of liked the Haley, but I think, you know, obviously that was kind of handled kind of strangely, and I won't get into that, but what was the other one? The Evolve from Nathan Alpha Man. I think that's a pretty interesting one as well, and if I'm going to get a 75%, I'll probably just save up for that one, I think. NP Spears is asking, what boards are we using right now? So I had to show it off before in the pre-show in the mail call, but I got my Baka 60 in recently. This is an unfinished Baka 60, so I have to decide what color I want to get it finished. But right now it's currently rocking GMK line with some novelty as I smack my mic with the keyboard. What about you, Jay? What are you using?
I'm using my JR1 currently. I have been using my Polaris with my work laptop, and I've been using my JR1 with my desktop, and the JR2 a fair bit as well. I just need my macros sometimes, depending on what I'm working on. Everything else hasn't kind of had a turn recently. The one board that I keep meaning to use that I haven't actually used since I built it is the Jane V2, the CE. It's literally had less than 20 seconds typing on it. So what? I need to use that more often. Yeah, it just sat there. I mean, it's literally just over there.
Use it more often. You have my address. So, like, if you want someone to get use out of that board, I'm just a nation away.
Just a nation away. You're a massive ocean away as well. Yeah,
trying to be funny. Anyways, let's see. Enemy says, you are correct. They are still using renders for the extras. Yeah, okay. I think we all kind of agreed on that. Shoko is a weeb set. So the designer of Shoko claims it is a weeb set, even though this run is not going to have Hiragana sub-legends. So that's kind of cool. I mean, it does have a Hiragana mono-legend option, which, you know, I guess would kind of fit in that as well. But it's also based off, you know, anime-esque material. So that's fair as well.
Yep.
All right. Ten Strong asking, what do you think about TKC running R2 Candy Bar after they sell their extras? I mean, I don't see a problem with running another round as long as they complete the first round. But obviously, if people are having issues with the color options, I would hope that gets sorted out before the round two. But
yeah, I agree. There's nothing wrong with a company or an individual running a second round for a group buy after they finish shipping the first. I think that's completely fine. There is nothing wrong with that at all. It happens a lot. But I do think they need to fix the colors. I think I did see another comment from Enemy saying that someone else had built another board and it looked the same as those. I would absolutely agree they need to fix that before they start to sell some more. At least update the color and say, look, guys, this isn't the color that we're going to be selling. It's not mint. It's this actual green. This is the real color. And then they need to do something to fix it for the people who bought it in the group buy. You know, what they need to do, I will leave it up to them and the people who bought the boards to decide. But yeah, you know, I think we're all on the same page here that needs to be fixed. But as long as they're clear with that and they're open about it, you know, there's nothing wrong with them selling another round of something if they've got want to produce it, that's fine.
Yeah.
Especially after the first one shipped, right?
Yeah. As long as they fix any issues that need to be fixed, I don't see a problem with running around too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Brick Cube says 24-hour show, Pog. I know. All right. I don't know what to say about that right now. There's so many other things that we're doing first, unfortunately, or fortunately, depending.
Yeah. On.
We can't really talk about it yet. Actually, I'm not going to talk about it. We do have some extended content coming soon. That's all I'll say. And you guys will know more in the near future. Let's see here. Pluto is asking, how many built boards do you have that have clicky switches? I currently have one.
Oh, no, I have two. I thought I had one, but I have two. Yes, I have two. I have a clipper with Phoenix stems. I can't remember what switch housings I've used actually on that, but that's the blue board that's just behind me here with the minimal on it. And then I have another board that's built, but it's tucked away in a drawer, and that's got box navies in it.
Yeah, I have my M60, my Dusk M60 has Kale Box pinks in it, which are absolutely lovely on that board, honestly. I really think the M60 benefits a lot from clicky switches. All right, it looks like we're actually caught up on questions just as we crossed the 3 hour mark, so this is probably a good time as any to head out there. Obviously, you guys have more questions. We have a Discord link below, our official Discord. You can join there. You can ask us whatever you want, whenever you want. And yeah, it's a great time. You can come hang out there and talk about keyboards or quesadillas or your pets or whatever. There's something for everyone, and it'll be
Yeah.
pretty awesome. Also, below the stream, you can find the link to our YouTube channel, which is where all the VODs are posted, usually 24 hours after the fact because of Twitch's terms of service. But you can find all of those there. And yeah, we do have a couple upcoming streams. So like I mentioned, tomorrow, Jay and I are going to be competing on what is effectively Keyboard Jeopardy over on twitch.tv/manofinterest. That's going to be 6 p.m. Pacific time, so the same show this or the same time this show normally starts. And yeah, come check us out there. Root for us, hopefully, or don't, whatever. We're going to be playing against the Mechs on Deck guys, and obviously we're all
It's going
good
to be fun.
friends, so it win or lose, it's going to be really fun. But obviously, we're going to absolutely dominate them. So it's gonna be a good time, and hopefully we'll all learn something from it. Also tomorrow, after that, I do plan on doing a build stream featuring the Mechanus Type X. So we're gonna play around with that. I have a WT60 PCB on hand. Might try it without a plate, see what kind of flex we can achieve. Might try it with a polycarbonate plate, see what kind of flex and sound we can achieve there. Maybe potentially a few different switches to check out. So it's gonna be kind of a Mechanus Type X testing stream, if you will. So if you're
Nice.
interested in that, that'll be tomorrow night, probably around 7:30 or 8 p.m. Pacific time. So it's going to be a little later than I would normally start, but that's obviously because we're going to be on the Key Quiz show, Jay and I, and I think that's
Nice.
going to last somewhere around an hour probably. So it's going to be after that. But of course, if you're in the Discord and you pay attention to the announcements channel, you will know when I'm going live. So if you're interested in the Mechanus
Yeah.
Type X, come check me out tomorrow.
Absolutely, yeah. I really enjoyed building my Type X about a month or so ago when I did that. It's a good board actually for the price. It's really nice. I think you really like it, Brian. Okay. I've also got a stream coming up on Sunday. I don't know what I'm going to be building yet. I've got like four choices. I need to pick and choose what I'm going to build. I haven't decided as yet. I might even put up like a sneaky poll and let you guys pick what I build. I don't know yet. We shall see how that goes. And then as soon as I finish that build stream, I'm going to carry on finishing the Lego Batmobile. It is at the side here. You might just be able to see the sneak peek of it towards the back. I will just carry on. So we'll finish the board build, we'll do the J-Score, we'll do everything else, and then I'll just do another hour or maybe two carrying on with the Lego build. I think we're 4 hours into it now, and we're about a third of the way through, so plenty more to go. Yeah, it's a huge
That
set, Brian.
is,
It's huge.
yeah. I remember, like, I watched some of it, and when you first pulled out a pack, and you're like, "There's 27 of these," and I was like,
Yeah.
"Whoa,
I
whoa!"
think I'm seven packets in. Yeah, so yeah.
That's wild to me. That's absolutely wild.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So Talisman says, are we all caught up on J scores? We are all caught up on J scores. Yes, we did that last week. We caught up on J scores because I'd run out of time at a couple of the end of build streams to do a J score. So we did catch up on those last week. So we're going to make a fresh start with the build this
Yeah,
week.
and I see a couple people in chat as well talking about Behind the Keyboard. If you've been watching that and enjoying that, thank you so much. It's been a lot of fun to do. Obviously, last week we had the wonderful Salvin on, and it was very educational. I learned a lot. Hopefully, you guys did as well. Before that, we had Nathan Kim on from Teha Types. He's a super awesome guy. I really highly suggest you go back and watch both those episodes because they're both very, very awesome and informative, in my opinion. And like you probably already are aware, tomorrow, Behind the Keyboard is going to be taking a break that week because we have the Key Quiz over on Man of Interest channel, and I'm going to be doing a build stream after that. But I do have a guest scheduled for next Friday as well as the Friday after, so we do still have Behind the Keyboard going strong. So hopefully you guys have been enjoying that as well. I've been trying to get better at it. I know I don't do the best job at broadcasting and presenting it, but I am trying to get better, and I'm always looking for constructive criticism as well. So
Hey, it's good to watch you grow while you're doing it, man. It's good to see that. I've
yeah.
really enjoyed them. It
Thanks,
has been
man.
good.
You don't, Jay, you're too wholesome though. You don't count.
All right, well, I'll tell you it's crap then. All right, it's crap. All the episodes
all right, well, do better next time. In that case, your opinion's wrong, and I don't care what you're saying about it.
Tenstrong did ask how the clock build went on. The clock's there in the background. You might not be able to make out the digits, but the Nixie clock is over there, and it's looking pretty good. Yeah, it's nice.
Yeah. Madrid saying more bathroom breaks. No, I usually only need one for every 3 or 4 hours, thankfully. But, you know, this I go through, I think this is like a 64-ounce cup. I go through about 8 to 10 of these every single day. And I try to drink less on the days that I do top clack, so I don't have to go during the show. But I just love hydration, man.
Fair enough. I just love hydration. My bane is coffee. I probably go back through 7 of these a day, which is, this is not a small mug. This is
that's a pretty big mug.
Yeah, it's a 28-ounce mug, and I go through quite a few of those a day.
Yeah. People asking if it's water? Yeah, water. I drink an insane amount of water every day, and I pretty much always have. Usually you just don't notice unless it's a 3-hour plus show. Anyways, that's going to do it for us today. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the show as much as we did. And yeah, look forward to the Keyboard Jeopardy show tomorrow at 6 p.m. Pacific on Man of Interest channel. I will share that in the announcements channel beforehand. Afterwards, join me in a nice little casual late night build stream where I check out the Mechanisca Type X. I'll post that in the announcements channel, of course, as well. That's going to be somewhere around 7:30 p.m. Pacific, maybe a little bit later. We'll have to see how the key quiz goes, but come join on that. And of course, come check out Jay on Sunday as usual. And we'll also be giving away game codes too. I'll be giving away game codes on my stream tomorrow. I presume Jay will probably be giving away game codes on his stream on Sunday.
That's tons just to give away.
We still have a lot to give away. So that's kind of what we're going to be doing during all this quarantine isolation stuff moving forward, and trying to keep people staying at home and playing some free games. So if you want to win some free games, make sure you're watching a lot of the build streams that we do, because we've been giving out a lot of them too. Doom Eternal. Give out 3 Doom Eternal game codes already.
Yeah,
that's a hype game, man. There's a lot of nice people out there that have been contributing a lot of really cool games. So shout out to all of you, and yeah, come check out these build streams. And if you want to win some stuff, or if you just want to come hang out and have a good time,
yeah. Always good to just hang out and chat.
Absolutely. So once again, thank you all so much for all the support, all the views, all the subs, all the bits. We greatly appreciate every single one of you that sits here and watches this show week to week. I know we don't say it often enough, but honestly, like, without you guys, it's all gone anyways. So thankfully you guys have been super supportive and awesome this whole time, and I just can't thank you guys enough. So thank you all so much, and enjoy the rest of your day and or night.
Yeah, thanks guys, and we'll see you again soon. See ya.